Chip, welcome to the Big Tone Show. First off today, we got a special guest, man. But before anything, we're going to introduce our new co-host, Icy Amy.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for having me here.
And today, man, we got Jay Stallion in the motherfucking house. What's poppin',
bro? What it do, man? Shout out my man's Big Tone.
Yes, sir. Appreciate you coming through, man.
Also, I love, bro. You already know how we do it.
Hell yeah, man. Crazy times right now, bro. There's a lot of crazy shit going on right now, huh?
Yeah, man. Shit, I just... trying to stay working, man, and keep my businesses afloat just like everybody else.
Yeah, it's tough out here, especially for small businesses.
All right, it's even harder because me and him, we both own barbershops, man.
Yeah, so. my clothing store been paying the rent for my barbershop.
Yeah, that's a blessing.
Oh, that's cool. So it's been taking off. I think I seen you post about it. That's good.
Yeah. No, my store be it'll be a year this year. We're gonna have a anniversary party.
Oh, nice.
Maybe like on the 30th or the 31st or something.
Oh, that's dope.
But yeah, the clothing store will be a year. The barbershop going on 4 years.
Oh, dang. Oh, shoot.
That first year is always the hardest hump, too, because I had a clothing store, too. And I that shit's harder, actually, than anything else to run because of... Yeah.
Inventory. Like, I didn't really make no money. I'm still not really making no because inventory.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, you need a lot of, like, you need a lot of shit.
Like, you got to put in... You got to invest a lot in order to see.
But you get caught chasing your tail with inventory. So, yeah. Like, say you order a bunch of those shirts.
Yeah.
They're allergic to bandejos, right? Say that shit's popping.
Yeah.
And but only 2-3X is selling, or extra large and mediums, and you get stuck with hella extra large or 2X. You know, it's kind of like you're chasing your tail because they're not going to reprint.
I feel it because we got our share. Ours is Amanecidos Apparel, and we're stuck with a whole bunch of mediums right now.
Yeah.
I just say, all right, I'm not going to buy no inventory for 60 days.
I got you.
I'm going to sell whatever here, and I'm not going to spend none on inventory. If they order something and I don't got it, I just call them, ask them to switch it.
Yeah.
Like, sometimes you just got to bow down because inventory will really fuck you up. You don't even be knowing, and you didn't fuck around and spend more money on bringing in clothes than you made.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
You would make $10,000 a month, but you didn't spend $12,000 on inventory.
Yeah.
Do you just sell your clothing, or you sell other people's brands too?
No, just mine.
Okay.
I just want to like build my shit first. Yeah. Like, I'm gonna sell other people eventually.
Yeah.
But I want to build my brand first. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, I want to like eventually get my shit in other stores. Of course, you know? Yeah. Like,
where's your store located?
It's in Modesto, 1501 Coffee Road.
Okay.
Motown 209. Yeah, that's a cool market.
Shout out Modesto.
Hell yeah. Nah, I tried the clothing, man, and I commend you. And I did my brand was the most popular shit in my store, but I tried to sell authentic sports gear. I didn't realize the politics in clothing. I went to Agenda, you know, Agenda Clothing Convention.
Yeah.
I went out there, I went to Long Beach, and I'm like, man, I'm gonna go up and meet with these other companies and shit. And they're like, oh, you need to make an appointment to meet with them, and they only meet with certain kind of vendors, even like cookies.
Oh,
I couldn't get cookies in my store. It Burns like, yeah, I got you.
He's like,
oh, bro, we're obligated to Mainland, which they're pretty close to you, so they can't sell to no moms and pops, I guess, or something like that.
Yeah.
So it's different.
Dang,
it's politics involved with clothing.
That's crazy. I guess that's the same for every business, though, right? There's always that background politics that the consumers don't see.
That's why I'm just focusing on my shit and get my shit at other stores because of the politics and shit.
Fuck, create your own lane, man. That's what I've been. That's what I'm doing with everything. Fuck it, man. Fuck knocking on the doors.
Yep.
I'm creating my own fucking goddamn door. So how's everything else going, bro? Music-wise, man, you staying busy with the music still?
Hell yeah, going good, man. I'm finna open the books up in a minute like the Mafia do and sign some new artists.
Nice.
But yeah, man, I'm just... focused on, because I was just doing a community service not too long ago, so I couldn't create music. I couldn't be as creative as I usually am or as I want to. So since I've been off, you know what I'm saying, I didn't drop 2 albums. I got me and DJ Fresh got another album coming out July 3rd.
Okay.
Me and the Mechanics got another album dropping in September for back to school. You know what I'm saying? So I just been playing catch up with the music, you know what I'm saying? Shooting videos every week.
I seen that.
You know what I'm saying?
How was that community service? Oh, my bad.
Nah, go ahead. That's a good question.
I mean, it was a life lesson. It was a life lesson. I had to do 186 days, which turned into like 214 days.
Dang. What did they have you doing? Because I know when I was doing it, they had me cleaning up homeless camps and the whole thing.
He made a TV show out of it, man. He was making it.
Really?
Damn near. They had me at the Manteca dump.
Yeah.
The fucking garbage the sanitation dump.
Dang. You was at the hard hat and everything.
Fucking garbage working.
They thought you was working. They thought you was really got a job.
They thought I had a job on the real.
Good job on getting your hands dirty. Hey, I did community service and they had us dropped off doing the side of the freeway and they said, yeah, start here. And it was like 100 some degrees and said, we'll pick you up here. I gave up, bro. I said, I'd rather go to jail. I go do my time. I went to the county, bro. I went and kicked it with the homies instead of picking that shit up. But it was only like a 30 days or something.
Damn,
shit,
I did community service when I was pregnant.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I wasn't like hecka far along, but yeah, I was.
What's up, man? Yeah, you staying busy, bro. Some real entrepreneurship, man. It shows that motherfuckers could do more than just rap. You know what I'm saying?
You could turn
that following into other opportunities, you know, open up more doors. You know, I've done the clothing, I've done the merch and stuff. You know, I find my niche. You know, my thing is open the door more into the cannabis industry and stuff like that.
Yeah, I want to get into that too.
Yeah, that's where a lot of people with the music game start branching off to that. You feel me? But it's the entrepreneurship. If you could start from the streets and you sell dope, you could run a legit business. You know what I'm saying?
I tell niggas that all the time. And just like with the weed shit, like niggas sold dope and weed hella years illegally.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't you get into it now that is legal? You know how to do it. Fucking phenomenal if you did it and got away with it illegally.
Straight up. Yeah. They don't want to pay taxes though.
So then what would you guys
do? That's it. But so, I mean, shit.
What would your motivation, what advice would you have for the fans that you guys have watching you that want to start going the legal route and making money the legal way, but feel like they got obstacles against them?
Yeah.
What advice would you guys give them?
I would say if you believe in something strongly, you got to just go for it.
Amen.
Like the biggest shot you miss is the one you never take.
Straight
Amen.
Up.
You feel like you going to miss every shot if you never take none.
Yeah.
You got to at least shoot the motherfucking ball.
Yeah.
And expect you're going to miss a few times.
Exactly.
I think people want to hit that home run. They want to hit that 3-point every time, man.
Yeah.
It ain't going to happen like that. You're going to have to miss those shots.
So you can't be scared to take a loss, pretty much.
You have to take
a loss. You got to understand that comes with the territory of wanting to take that next step in your life.
I done been in the music game for a long time, and around in California or the Bay Area or just Northern California or West Coast music, period. Like, what I am now, like, respected, so-called legend or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
It didn't just start like that from day one. Like, I've been in studios and couldn't get on songs.
Yeah.
I've rapped on songs and then been taken off songs. Yeah.
Was there ever moments that you felt defeated, like you wanted to stop this music shit, even though that's what your passion was, or did you just keep going no matter what?
No, because it was dry. It's drive. It's like a pimp. If you love pimping and you love hoes and one hoe leave or a hoe blow up, that's not going to make you want to stop pimping.
Yeah.
That's going to make you want to go get two more hoes. You feel me? Like,
It
just made me want to go harder. And
also a real pimp, man.
I bet I won't get took off no more songs.
Yeah.
You feel me? It just, you know what I'm saying? Like, if you love something, if you truly love something, and you get defeated at it or you're not successful at it, it doesn't discourage you and make you want to do it more.
Yeah.
Michael Jordan said he got cut from his varsity freshman team. For you to get cut off the varsity freshman team, you has to not be that good.
Yeah.
The junior varsity team.
Yeah,
as
I know
freshman,
sir. Yeah.
He got cut off the junior varsity team. Not the varsity team.
Mm-hmm.
The junior varsity team. He say next year he was starting shooting guard and shooting guard in the 10th grade on the varsity team.
Yeah.
So it boils down
to. So he never played for the junior varsity team.
Yeah.
So it's a matter of one's integrity. Integrity.
I think it's when you get that, like you said, you get taken off a song.
Yeah.
It's a pride thing too. When you know you got something and people don't believe in you, and you know it in
you
your heart.
You want to show them.
Yeah, all right, motherfucker, you going to take me off a song? All right, motherfucker, I ain't going to make the team. You're going to see. You know what I'm saying? And I'm sure, if it wasn't some, like say Michael Jordan that got cut, maybe he didn't have it all there. He had the fundamentals, but I bet you that boy went to work.
I bet you that boy
got in the gym.
That's the whole point of the story. He got cut because he wasn't good enough. Mm-hmm. But it didn't discourage him from becoming the best fucking player we ever seen on the face of the earth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They said Oprah, too, didn't have a face for TV. At one time, she was taking
off. Called her fat and all type of shit.
I think that goes for everybody that's trying to, you know, I feel like a lot of people limit themselves when it comes to their dreams and aspirations. A lot of people just say, no, I can't do it. Or I don't have the confidence enough to do it. Yeah. And everyone else's voice gets in their ear instead of just saying, man, fuck what everyone says. I'm going to do it because I know I could do it. Without nobody behind me co-signing me, you know what I mean? Everybody wants a co-signer nowadays.
Especially with the rap shit though, because everyone's trying to rap. It's easy because everybody thinks they're gonna drop a song and blow up. Yeah. Everyone's like, "Oh, this is my new shit. I'm the next one up." So they don't realize.
And everybody wanna put on a jetpack and just shoot to the top in the rap game
instead of putting in the legwork.
Yeah. Nobody wants to take the stairs no more.
You gotta take your bumps and bruises too. You know what I mean? Like a lot of people want that safety. Shit. And that's what, like I said, it goes back from being from the streets. If you could sell dope, you could be an entrepreneur. Because when you slang a dope, nothing's for show. Yeah. You don't know who to trust. You don't know when you're going to get hit. You don't know what's going to happen. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and when your foundation ain't strong, that's when you fall easy. Like that's why one-hit wonders don't, because those aren't real fans. Mm-hmm. Mm. They just like the song.
They wrote the way.
They don't like the man. Mm-hmm. So when that man doesn't have no more songs, he just fade away. They don't love the man. Like when you love an artist and he ain't dropped in a while, you be like, damn, I miss it. When such and such gonna drop? Like, you feel me? When you haven't took the time to create that loyal fan base by letting the fans get to know who you are inside, not just your music.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And give them another reason to love you besides your dope.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? That's what makes longevity in the game.
Look at you dropping gems.
Besides being like a one-hit wonder. Yeah.
No, I like that because that's something they called you creating your likeness. You're creating yourself a brand.
Like you, bro. Motherfuckers love you.
Yeah, appreciate that, man.
Like everywhere you the only, like, not the only, but the first Mexican they say, period.
Yeah, right on, man. Appreciate
they
that, man.
They love you everywhere. Like, bro, you need to do some shit with my new Big Tone. I'm like, bro, me and Big Tone got shit. I'm like, look at that. They're like, oh, y'all do? Like, oh, Stylin', we love you. Like.
You know what you just said, though? And I laced this to my little homies. I've worked on that. Tough to have people
build your personal foundation. You build your foundation.
Because if I was only known for a song or this and that, because I ain't the best rapper, I don't make the best music, and I don't stay consistent with the music enough. So, but if I was only known for that one little thing, I would have had my time came and went. But
exactly.
But I've utilized this so many different ways, and I've kind of create that. I feel like I create a connection with my following. So I don't need a big, huge amount of millions of followers. I just have a good enough foundation where I could be successful. That's, I'm like a mom's a pop store. You know, you got your chain, a restaurant, you got Chili's, you got all this shit. Mm-hmm. I'm like the little local hood store where people come eat every day and still support my products. You know what I'm saying?
That quality.
Yeah, so that's
that
good
quality to
that's
what
that's
you
some
do.
Real game. The real game you gave him. You know, he got some gems right there, man.
Got to.
For y'all listen up, man. Work on yourself. Work on your craft and make people love you.
Mm-hmm. Believe in yourself when no one else don't believe.
Let them get to know you, because ain't nobody perfect. Motherfuckers see you got flaws just like them. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Motherfuckers see you didn't went through the same shit they didn't went through.
Yeah. How was it like getting into the music industry and coming from, you know, the life that you've lived and having the friends that you had? Did you lose a lot of friends once you started getting known?
I lost a lot of maybe associates.
Associates.
I didn't really like lose no real friends, because real friends are happy for you if you're successful and you feel, and if they're your real friends, you know what I'm saying, you still go back and fuck with them. You know what I'm saying? Like, one of my best friends was just over my house like 3 days ago. We've been friends over 30 some years.
Yeah.
Like, we got separated in fourth grade. The teacher moved our desks in fourth grade. It's like, no, y'all can't be together. Fuck no. Like, you sit over there, put us on separate in the
classroom.
Why,
you guys are the class clowns or what?
No, we just, you know.
It's bullshit.
You know,
talking
bullshit,
about
bullshit, yeah, throwing pencils at each other.
When you get with your girls, like, you feel me?
Yeah,
like,
we be talking shit. We talk shit.
Like, it's like, no, I cannot have y'all two together.
That's a blessing, bro, because I don't have that. I don't have none of my partners I grew up with. Everyone I had close to me got lost to this game, either death or prison. You know what I'm saying? The statistics, what they say. Everyone I had close to me like that, I have nobody like that. I can say
that's crazy.
That was my dog. Like, you know, it's always like, rest in peace when I talk about someone like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's the game catches up in a lot
rest
of different ways.
Rest in peace
ways,
to Woody Wood.
Rest in peace to Wood, man. R.I.P. You know that, man. I rep my bro to the end. And you know what? I didn't meet Wood until later on in life, until I started rapping, and he gave me that opportunity to do something. That's why he changed my life. Because other than that, bro, all I knew was out here banging, thugging, and balling. You know what I'm saying? And he gave me something to look up to. Like, I could actually do that. You know what I'm saying? So, Yeah, man, you need that. You got a following. I got a following. We got that where we could show people there's another way. You feel me?
Exactly. I hustle, stack, invest.
Yeah.
Three steps. Hustle, stack, invest.
Give them that game. And then
what would you say are good investments? Because, you know, nowadays, a lot of people, what do they put their money in?
A lot of people don't know. They want to do something, but they don't know what to do with it.
They don't know how to keep that longevity in that income. You know, I heard a quote, invest in what makes you money. Invest in money that makes you money. But a lot of people don't even know the avenues of what makes you money. What makes you money?
There's two type of investments. There's investments like silent stock or partner investments where you just put up your money and you don't really got a lot to do with the business part. And then there's investments like creating brand investments, like opening up your own stuff, investments like that. But something that I would say about opening up your own businesses, like just say for instance, a barbershop.
Yeah.
That's a good investment because it ain't really too much overhead once you get done setting the barbershop up. It's not like a clothing store where you gotta keep selling clothes.
Yeah.
You sell dope, you run out, you got to buy more dope. Yeah. You sell clothes, you run out, you got to buy more clothes.
Yeah.
You don't have to. There's no limited amount of haircuts that you have that you can run out of.
But then during times like these where the economy is shot to shit right now, I know barbershops are struggling because they don't qualify for that loan that was put out. So then you guys are stuck with having to pay. So like what's the, you all know, the pay bills, your bills, you know.
And that's something out of the blue that happened. That's the first time in history.
Shit like that. That's the risk that you have to take. Like the motherfuckers that own the motherfuckers that own the World Trade Center.
Yeah.
Like there's no fucking way in the world they could have put that in their insurance. Like, maybe you need to insure your buildings if they get hit by a fucking plane.
Yeah.
You feel me? Like nobody we was going to have a pandemic and the world was going to shut down.
But you know what? I think this is a good opportunity to teach people. To like you said, stack their money, have that rainy day money.
Yes.
Don't just go spending your money on bullshit. Make sure that you got money tucked for shit like this that you can't predict that happens.
You must have saw my post.
No, I swear I didn't. You said that?
See my rainy day post? When the shit first hit. It's back in March when the pandemic first hit. I just was like, when they say save your money for a rainy day, this is what they're talking about.
Straight up.
Oh, see, now my dad.
They're not actually talking about fucking rain.
Yeah.
They're talking about shit like this.
When
the world is in a pandemic and everything is closed and it's hard to get some fucking toilet paper.
That's what I was going to say.
That's what they're talking about. Yeah. That's what they're talking about when they say, save your money for a rainy day.
Yeah, I was blessed to have my dad like put me up on game like that, but I feel like a lot of people don't have people to tell them that.
Yeah. You know,
a lot of people don't have that example of like, this is the smart way to go about stuff.
See, there's two ways. There's two ways you can look at that. I'm a believer of saving money, but also I'm a believer of making your money work for you.
Exactly.
Because sometimes having money put away ain't doing nothing for you. You know what I'm saying? Like I'm blessed where, we in a pandemic, but I'm able to keep everything going because I had saved for a rainy day, whatever you want to call it. But I also have other investments where things come in, you know, so... I'm gonna answer your question too because I was thinking about that when you want another investment is to invest into your passion, invest into something that you want to do.
I was gonna touch on
because
that.
Like he said, you want to do a cooking show. You love cooking. You never know that cooking might turn into a restaurant. That might come into a lot of viewers, something you love doing, and it turn into a business. You know what I'm saying?
And something like that is like what people don't even understand. Like that cooking show on YouTube, Gordon Ramsay could come and be like, hey. I want to give you a restaurant.
Yeah.
I want to open a restaurant called Ghetto Gourmet, which are based on your fucking
your brand.
Yeah.
Like they do that.
Yeah. I guess it just opens doors, right?
Joe Rogan just got 100 mil for his podcast from Spotify.
Yeah, that's crazy. Yep.
And what's the name? Just they just okayed him a show.
Who's that?
Who? MTV. Tory Lanez for Quarantine Radio. Yep.
Oh, because he started.
He was doing that on his live, right?
Yeah, he started the live thing. Yeah. I think because of that, they were able to start. They're gonna start trying to monetize IG live.
Yeah, they need to.
Yeah. He was like get millions of viewers on that shit.
He was like, he don't know what they're gonna do yet, but they okay to do like a show, Of course, obviously it can't be Quarantine Radio no more because we're not quarantined no more. Yeah. But. That nigga MTV finna give him a show.
Yeah. That's hype.
From all the views and the traffic he was getting from Quarantine Radio.
Yeah. That's tight.
Shit, bring that bag
out,
man.
That's a whole check. Yeah, to me, another check.
Shit, I'd be like, yeah, man, start your own channel because you could cut out the middle, man. You get the viewers on your own channel alone, and you don't need MTV nowadays, man. MTV needs motherfuckers like that nowadays.
Hell,
you know
yeah.
what I'm saying?
That's what Puffy did with that Revolt.
Yeah, exactly.
Crazy. Nigga, like, like we got BET, we got MTV, but I watch MTV and I watch BET, and I see shit that I wish both of them shows had that they don't have.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like some of the old shit that they took off that they thought people didn't really give a shit no more that they do. Just like little talk shows. Not talk, like just little video shows where they do a little talking before, like The Basement and shit.
Yeah, 106 like, and Park they had back
like,
in the day.
Like Revolt got a lot of little shit like that where they do a lot of talking and to give a lot of knowledge on shit that's going on in the world and shit like... And that's what MTV and BET was missing. Yeah. MTV and BET got too focused on the money. Like, BET got, like, hella TV shows now.
Yeah.
Like, Boomerang, Mary Jane, like, they turning, they, like...
They need Comedy Central
like
back,
like, they got, they got more away from the music and more into actual the television shit.
Yeah.
Where MTV did, too, with all them shows and shit. But Puffy, that Revolt... His shit is basically focused on music again.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it is. Like, you look around and you see what's missing in your element, though.
Yeah. I think people, I think
and you feel that void.
Yeah, I think they capitalize off of what's making money in that moment. You know what I mean?
And people that think that it's going to make money. Yeah.
Yeah. What I'm trying to know, though, is what inspired this Ghetto Gourmet? Well, what was that? You just were cooking one day, and you just were like, "Man, I wanna do a show and putting my people on how to cook."
No, like so, I come from a family of chefs. Mm-hmm. So my grandfather was a chef, my uncle was a chef. My mom could cook very, very good, but she wasn't a chef. But she could cook very, very good
because
her brother and her dad were chefs.
Yeah.
So you feel me? And so I just learned how to cook from just watching my mom and shit. Just you know, and then. The Ghetto Gourmet shit just come from, like, when you wasn't, like, my mom wasn't rich or nothing.
Yeah.
So my mom used to make, like, gourmet meals out of Top Ramen and shit.
Yeah.
Like, whip shit up. Like, when you didn't even know that this whole meal cost, like, $3.
You gonna make something work out that motherfucking pantry, man.
That's cool. That's cool.
And then, so I started cooking, and then, when I cook, people used to just be like, your food tastes hella good.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So then I started watching Chopped.
Mm-hmm.
You ever heard of the show Chopped?
Yeah.
And then I started just doing that. Like, because on Chopped, they just give them a basket full of recipes, and you just got to make the best out of it.
Yep.
So I just started playing Chopped at home, just like that's seeing tight. What I had in my refrigerator, seeing whatever I had in my cabinet, and just making up shit, just coming up with the best of whatever I could come up with.
Hey, the best food comes out of just going with the flow. I swear it does.
I was like, when you're
and then you're like, oh, it needs a little bit of this, it needs a little bit of that. What do I got up in here? That's cool.
Man, I need to come visit styling because I be door dashing every damn day, man.
Do you really? You know how unhealthy that is?
You busy, man. When you big, you got to, hey, you know what? I'm going to order this motherfucker and hopefully it's here before I leave.
20 minutes on the real.
Man, I don't have time to cook like I used to, but that's.
I can't eat out that much. I think after a minute, it just feels, you know, it just kind of, you feel sluggish and whatnot. And then I'll just be craving like a home-cooked meal.
Yeah. What's your main dish, bro? Y'all know you got a specialty. What's the main thing that everybody want?
I don't eat beef no more, but they say my pot roast go crazy. Like I'ma cook hella shit on the show. I'ma probably cook shit that I don't eat because I don't eat pork or beef. I ain't gonna cook no pork, but I'ma cook beef on there for sure because I know a lot of people still eat beef and they still want them good ass recipes even though I don't eat it
because
I ate it. I'm 37. I ate the shit for 36 years.
Yeah, why you stop?
Yeah,
just want to be more healthy. Like that shit be had you sluggish.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Shit had you constipated. Like I'm too old to be feeling like that.
Yeah, you still eat dairy? A
little bit.
Yeah, I heard that dairy creates a lot of mucus in the body, and mucus is like the main thing that starts
viruses and
infections.
That's one of my partners. Dr. Savy
talked about that.
Yeah. I started taking the Irish sea moss, and you ever heard of that stuff? Red, all this crazy shit. I got it in a little powder. I take and it do make
only
me feel better.
Only dairy I really eat is like cheese, though.
I love cheese.
I don't really drink too much milk.
Yeah, I don't.
Shit.
Yep, same.
I cook with it, but I don't really drink it like
no cereal. Ain't fucking with no cereal.
Damn, I fuck with cereal. Like once a month. My man, shoot, that is a guilty pleasure right
I eat a bowl of cereal once a month when I'm super duper high.
Ice creams, frozen yogurt. See, I love frozen yogurt. I got two frozen yogurt spots by the house, and I be taking my kids all the time when they open. Like, what's up? Let's go get some frozen yogurt, man.
Damn,
that
man,
shit be
I
good.
Ate a banana split last night.
My weaknesses are the Mexican quesos. Yeah, you know, you do a little carne asada. You need, you know, that queso on top.
Yeah, man, you gotta add that cheese, man.
Oh yeah, I love queso. Oh my god. Every time I go to Chipotle, I put queso on my burrito. Oh
boy, the Chipotle, that's the Chipotle king right there, little homie, and that motherfucker three times a day. They walk in, they applaud.
Crazy.
Right, boy, welcome back.
Hey, they already know what you want or what?
You get free Chipotle and shit just because he in there so damn much. Get his man a free bowl. Get his man a free bowl, man. Yeah, nah, I fuck with Chipotle because when you're trying to eat healthy on the go, there's only a few options. If you want to eat healthy and you want to like eat on the
too
go,
much shit.
Yeah, you know you might be able to get some Puerto Loco chicken, but that shit still got hella salt. You know, Chipotle, you got very few options. We got like a little salad place out here, man, but that's about it, man. And I try to eat healthy, but it's hard. Door dashing and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's very hard.
Shit, I got a meal prep company now. They deliver my meals actually every Sunday, so I get those, but I run through them pretty fast.
Is the food good?
It's healthy, so it's not like hella delicious. But it's like chicken and brown rice and shit like that.
Yeah.
You know, motherfucker, my genetics ain't good, man. If I eat burritos for a whole week, more my stomach start getting bigger, my arms start getting smaller and shit, start looking like a little dinosaur and shit. So yeah, I gotta work harder to stay at least alright, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. For real.
Hey, you're looking pretty fit.
I know, I lost like 15 pounds.
Yeah, you did, huh? You was a little chubby for a minute.
That's
huh?
when I stopped eating beef, it ain't really like so. In a week, I would eat at least like probably one burger, like one burrito, probably like one steak.
Yeah.
You take that shit out your diet every week, like that shit hella heavy. And then on top of that, you just don't eat as much, period, because it ain't too much shit to eat. Yeah, you don't eat beef.
You don't crave
pork
as much.
Yeah.
That shit addicting because, like, when you eat a burger, you be wanting to eat a steak or something. You be wanting to eat more. That shit do addict.
It ain't really too much shit that I eat. So, like, I really just, I don't eat a lot. Like, I be having to sometimes make myself eat.
Yeah.
Because it really ain't too much shit I eat.
Yeah. I heard a lot of vegans talk about that. Like, when you could finally master being able to cut out certain stuff, meat and dairy, that you go through, like, 2 weeks of, like, I don't know, feeling
withdrawals.
Aggressive. Yeah,
withdrawals.
Like withdrawals. I know my man went through that, and he was rude.
Yeah.
I was like, you need to eat a steak because you're acting crazy.
I get hangry than a motherfucker, man. If I ain't ate shit, I said, bro, have me, I just eat a super burrito right before this motherfucker, man, so I got some damn patience and shit.
I get like that if I ain't smoke, boy. Yeah. Man. If I ain't smoke me a joint, I be antsy than a motherfucker.
Really?
Man, I used to be
hell
like
yeah.
That. Yeah, man.
I just get pissed off when my food's
I smoke, but I don't know if it's not PSD or something. I can't smoke too much in another public. I turn into I don't like the person I become.
You get paranoid.
I get paranoid, but I overlook too many people.
I think you smoking indica, sativa?
No, it don't matter. I smoke, everything's a hybrid. Okay. I mean, I smoke, I love getting high, but I just can't be out there and about no more, man. I be riding with, you know what I'm saying, tripping, police, I don't know, man. I gotta be on my P's and Q's a little bit more, and I chill when I'm in the studio. When I'm at home, I like to enjoy, you know what I'm saying?
I got partners like that. My nigga like, bro, I can't smoke. He's like, bro, I'm fucking kill somebody. I be paranoid as fuck.
I've had
bro.
That happen.
Like, I'm fucking kill
I ain't
somebody
kill nobody,
if I smoke.
You know what I'm saying, on camera, but I've had that happen where I've been in the situation and that's one thing that put
you
a red flag.
I
had my thing on me, and I almost hit my homie on accident thinking it was someone else. I was tripping.
Yeah,
really?
Everything's like
how much do you smoke?
It ain't the smoke.
Don't tell me you took like 2 hits and you were trying
It's when you've been through some real shit.
Yeah.
And sometimes when you get high, everything starts seeming real again. Like you start having flashbacks and
like
shit.
Like PTSD?
Maybe. I don't know. Shit. I don't know. Motherfuckers done seen some real shit. Yeah. Shit fuck with your mind. It don't really trip on it until you. And then that's when weed just brings it back out to me. So it makes me trip. Like, man, this motherfucker been driving by too many damn times. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That dude, don't look familiar. He look, man. You know what I'm saying? I just start tripping on shit. So that's why
I
don't get high in public as much.
Weed,
as I
think, gets you more aware of your internal self.
That's why I smoke body weed. I don't smoke high weed. I'll be forgetting which is which.
Yeah.
Indica's body. Indica's like the more like in the couch.
Everything's hybrid.
Yeah.
They don't
like
have
heavy,
no fully sativas and indicas.
The sativa's
no
the more
yeah.
the brain weed, the energetic weed, the
yeah,
the one where
so
you
so I don't like sativas
like
cuz that's
yeah,
the that shit make you paranoid. So I just have this one time. So I was living in Sacramento. So I've been living in Sacramento for a long time. I've been driving back and forth from Sacramento, Oakland, fine with no license doing this for like 2 years. Like 2 years. No license. No, not like 2 years, like 1 year for sure though. No license. Fine. Back and forth. Man, I smoked some motherfucking sativa, nigga. I'm leaving Oakland. Bruh, my whole time on the freeway, I'm thinking, oh my God, I'm finna get pulled over.
Everybody police too. Everybody police behind you.
Oh, shit.
I'm like, you're going too fast. Slow down, nigga. But me being the nigga who I am, like, I know how drugs make your body feel. Like,
you could overpower it with your brain, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So, I'm like, bro, you're paranoid from the fucking weed.
Yeah.
You chill out. Like, you good. Like, you're paranoid from the fucking weed. Like, I hit a fucking, big old Hennessy bottle one time. I hit a big old Hennessy bottle one time. The motherfucker was spiked with some pills.
Oh, shit.
Oh, my God. What
you didn't know that? You didn't know that?
I didn't know ecstasy. I didn't know I didn't know no pills was in it, but.
Who the fuck does that?
Yeah, a lot of people used to do that back in my day.
You know, we just in the studio. It's like hella niggas, yeah. Bottles going around. It was me, Jack, Huss. It was one of them nights. We had a show, I think, in Oakdale or something. I don't know. We had a show. It was one of them nights. We went to the studio.
Yeah.
After that, and it's just bottles going around, and I hit one of the bottles, but I know how. I'm like, ooh, shit.
Something hit me a little different right there.
I'm like, ooh, I'm on.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
I'm like, ooh, I'm on ecstasy.
You never pop ecstasy before that or not?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I know. Ooh, I'm like one of them bottles spiked.
Yeah.
That nigga Huss like, oh. Styling, you hit the spike bottle. I'm like, yeah. He like, oh, my bad. I'm like, it's good, nigga. Like, I know, but like, I didn't know, but like, I know how it feel.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It wasn't like, but for a motherfucker that don't know that or get high or something, that shit probably would have sent them to John George.
Yeah.
Feel me?
Yeah.
Like, just like the same thing with the weed shit.
Yeah.
Like,
I feel like I can't smoke weed around certain people just because I feel like I get more in tune with my energy and other people's energy.
Yeah,
you know, so when someone got like some internal demons that they haven't dealt with and I'm feeling your energy, see, all of a sudden high. That's you fucking tripping up on my shit. Energy. No, it's a real thing. It's really real. Like, I swear there's like, I can see like people's like true colors when I'm high. Like, I don't know.
I used to think like that because I used to pop hella ecstasy. I used to do hella ecstasy pills. Like, I used to pop that shit.
Not me. That shit was an ugly ass come down.
Same shit. Same shit. They turned it into capsules.
We
whatever.
Made a whole mixtape off ecstasy, nigga. And the mixtape was called You Ain't On.
Because
we was on.
That's a Dizzle boy.
You Ain't On.
That shit on. Yeah, now that was, I think that was a trend too, though. Like, everybody sip lean, and that's a trend. You know, everyone popping prescriptions and shit.
That was the best fucking time in the Bay Area with people and in music in general.
Not to glorify this shit.
Everybody wasn't funking, nigga. Everybody was high, and everybody was loving everybody. Just think about it back then. The Thizz Pill era. Everybody worked with everybody. Everybody had songs with everybody.
True that.
Yeah.
Everybody was high.
Yeah.
Everybody was high. It was like, nigga, this was like the new hippie era.
It's euphoric.
Remember when LSD hit and the hippies was all in love?
Yeah.
And everybody fucking everybody.
It went from motherfuckers acting hella hard, like from the super gangster 90s to acting hella hard to having fun. Like, you know, it brought the...
Because it's a euphoric drug. That's why
it brought
you got
the
that
hippie shit out of people.
I just remember people being off ecstasy and always saying, I love you, bro.
The fuck you mean you love me, bro?
I love you, bro.
Hey, I remember one time, though, like, when that shit hit, it do make everything look... It make, like, a random chick that you would never probably look at. Like, damn, she hella beautiful all of a sudden. I never noticed she was that good looking, girl.
Oh, my God.
Like, she do kind of, like, enhance everything.
Yeah.
You know what
I'm
saying?
Yeah, no, definitely.
Bro, motherfucker.
Even to touch.
Yeah, to touch everything.
To touch.
Bro, you drop something, a motherfucker pick it up and give it to you. You be like, oh,
your
my
skin
God,
feels
you're so nice.
Hey,
oh, my God, you're heaven sent.
I remember this one time I thought it wasn't gonna hit me. It was like a triple stack. What are they, triple stack? Remember that? I hit a triple stack and it didn't hit me.
What was it though? What kind of e-pill?
It was a blue Nike or some shit, a pink dolphin. I forgot what they was called. Was, but anyways, I took another one. This motherfucker didn't hit. It's a dud. So I popped another one and they both hit me hella hard. And my jaw just kept like, it just got stuck out this way though. And everyone's like, bro, what's wrong with your jaw? I'm like, what you mean? So I kept trying to push it back.
He had that Bobby Brown.
I'm trying to push it back in.
He had that Bobby Brown.
I was tripping all night on my...
Dang.
Nigga, did this ever happen to you? I used to... Look, this is some cold, dope fish shit. I used to love when I pop my pill and then my shit finally kick and I get the... You ever got the Joker chatter?
What you mean?
What the hell?
Where your shit go like this?
Oh, yeah. Your jaw. Yeah. I would chew hella gum.
Like this.
What?
You know them little thing that you wind up?
Yeah.
Like that, like this. Like you cold? Like you're shivering. A pill to make your jaw do that when it's 100 degrees outside.
What?
Yes. I think like you freezing like this.
I see the lockjaw from the Coke and the Mexicans all the time, I haven't seen that in the ecstasy.
This ain't lockjaw.
That's crazy.
This chatter. This ain't lockjaw.
Really?
I do this. I don't do this shit.
I call that boxing.
Yeah, that's that left and right.
I call that boxing. Lockjaw is when your shit just stay like this.
I remember chewing a whole pack of gum because my jaw was, I kept chewing gum.
See, this shit is so crazy. I got names for that shit.
Shit. Your boy said boxing. That's called boxing.
Boxing is when your shit like this. Damn. Your jaw boxing back and forth like this.
That shit do fuck you up though after a while though. Like it stop hitting you. When you keep taking them, you chase that first high, because when you first start popping and they hit you, you feel like heaven. Then they don't hit you as hard, so you got to keep. I think that's why people become, that's why dolphins become dolphins. They're always chasing that high. Before you know, your body needs this shit. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I quit because my dick stopped getting hard.
Pop a Viagra and a Thiz pill, man, at the same time.
No way.
Once that shit started doing that, I'm cool. It was over.
It do that.
Dang.
Yeah.
Did that affect
you? So long, my friend.
Hey, I remember a homie telling me, like, not to get all disrespectful on the show, but I remember my boy telling me he was popping pills and the little female was on him. He told straight up, like, I'm so this down, my dick ain't working for shit. And he just kept it 100, just like, it's shriveled up tonight, it's done.
It's over.
Dang.
Drugs, man. Drugs do things to your body, man.
No, yeah, I mean, it fucks with your chemical balance.
There's ones that were more heroin-based, and it sounds sad, like, we're not glorifying this shit now by any means. Yeah, it's just history, you know what I mean?
Yeah. But
some are more heroin-based, some are more methamphetamine-based, you know what I mean? It was just a compound of it all.
Some are more speed-based. Yeah.
Hey, do you guys feel like there was any after effects after doing that? Because
the calm down.
But, like, even to now that you're not doing it, because you guys don't know, but I did crystal for a while.
Yeah.
And I stopped, and I feel like now I still see the effects of that. Like, sometimes I just go 100 miles an hour all the time, and it's not something that is explainable. Sometimes I could be talking about it,
like,
and I'll
be smiling.
Did you
smoke a bowl, girl?
No, I didn't smoke. I never smoked it, I swear, but I used to snort it, you know? But I could definitely still feel the effect. There's times where just my heart will start racing out of nowhere, and I just feel like a shit ton of anxiety, know it's because it affected me that way, you know?
I don't know. Do you feel effects from years after that, from popping pills? I don't know if I do, maybe.
My back always hurting. They say pills fucked up your
back. Is that right? I got bad back, too. My back safe fucked up.
Also, that's because they suck up your spinal fluid.
Is that right?
Really?
Yeah.
Dang, I didn't know that. Yeah, that's crazy. So, it's crazy what drugs will really do to your body.
We got bad backs from our ecstasy days.
Damn, maybe, because I stay having bad backs, bro.
No, my back hurt all the time.
I used to go get spinal taps. They had to put injections in my back.
That's what I said, to take your spinal fluid.
Yeah.
You had to go
that
get
makes
them
sense
injections.
Now. I just learned something new from styling, man. Yes. Ecstasy fucked my back up. Yeah. That's the new slap.
Dang. Have you guys tried the cannabis balm for stuff like that, for your back hurting?
Oh, the weed, like Vaseline.
Yeah, I guess that would technically be more from, like, muscle.
Yeah.
Muscle pain, right?
Yeah, no, that shit.
If it's spinal,
that's spinal fluid.
That's...
It dry your spinal fluid out for whatever reason. I don't know.
I want to change the subject, man, but I was just thinking, I think it's a good time to talk about shit like this. All this shit going on right now, man, I don't want to damper the mood or nothing like that. We're talking about good times, but there's a lot of shit going on right now, man. I think it's a good opportunity for us to speak on something.
Yeah.
You know, all the stuff that's going on right now, it seems like everything's divided. You know what I mean? It's either you're one way or another right now, right? And, you know, obviously, you know, people are starting to see the wrongdoings and shit. You know what I mean? The you know, the police been fucking with people. The police been getting away with a lot, you know, stuff like that. But it's also, I've been noticing lately, it's been people are trying to divide black and brown people too. I don't know if you've seen some stuff
on the internet. I see it all.
And I seen something in Chicago where they were saying that the Latin Kings were taking off on any black people that were coming into them. Did you see that clip that I think Baller posted? But then it comes to find out that it was
the looters.
Anybody just protecting their property.
They wasn't doing that. I used to live in Chicago and I know like they all funking, but I had a great, like my partner Latin Joe, he was a Latin King. One of my best friends out there, like them gangs out there. I'm older now, so I don't know how them young niggas is now.
Yeah, shit changed
for sure. When I was out there, like it wasn't, Mexicans and blacks weren't trying to kill each other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like the Latin Kings, like the Four Corner Hustlers, the P-Stone Rangers and shit, like they all was like the Vice Lords and shit. Mm-hmm. Like they wasn't trying to, like it was funk, but they wasn't trying to kill each other.
Yeah.
It was just more about making money.
They had their own little personal issues between hoods and shit. Yeah,
about making money. Like matter of fact, my homie name was Spanish Joe.
Okay.
Spanish Joe.
Yeah.
He was a Latin King and we was so fucking cool.
Yeah.
Like hella cool.
But I see the media or social media a lot of people are trying to divide because people are bringing up certain shit like, fucked up shit happens everywhere, but it's like they add fuel to the fire. You know what I'm saying?
I think they want that, though. They want that division.
They pick and choose the negative shit to spread out.
Yeah. Because you know I know, like, L.A. always had racial tensions.
Yeah, always. Yeah.
L.A. always had. I know you're a little younger, so. Mm-hmm. But L.A. always had racial tensions.
Remember the T-shirt shit?
Who's that? What?
In L.A., the Mexicans, they was killing any black person who was wearing a white T-shirt.
I don't remember that.
Are you for real?
Yeah, that was like a few years ago. Not a few, like 10, 15 years.
There was always a war between races in L.A. That's why even Mexicans, Northern California, Southern California, always had different views. You know, they've always labeled us. Oh, they call us that. We try to act black and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying?
That's because we never had them big Mexican and black wars out here like those other.
We're more of a melting pot out here too.
So they try to say that y'all trying to be black or whatever. That's not. They're just mad that their divide and conquer doesn't work in Northern California.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Well, the divide and you, definitely. You feel me? Me and you right here.
Yeah.
Nigga, this ain't like this my partner. Like
it shouldn't be a division at all.
Years ago. Like this ain't nothing. Like he ain't just called me up and we just, and it's the first time I'm meeting him and we like.
So what would you say to the youth that watch this then and are those people that feel like, well, you know, Mexicans should stay with the Mexicans, blacks should stay with the blacks. And
that's ignorant,
It's ignorant?
Straight up.
Yeah. I agree. Ignorant. I think we're all just a different shade of brown.
Well, see, like I said, go back to Northern California. It goes on how you're raised and how you talk. So, like, if you were raised, and I might have said this on the show or after we talked. If you were raised in Boston, you would talk like you're from Boston. You'd have that Boston accent, right?
Yeah.
If you were raised in down south, you would probably sound like you're down south. If you're Texas, you'd be like, it's going down. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You talk like that. We're from Northern California. We talk like the Bay Area.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I've gotten that a lot amongst my own family, too, though. I've had a lot of my family that will tell me, oh, you kick it more with, like, the Negros, you know? I'm not hecka paisa. I'm not hella Mexican. I'm more Americanized. But even though I'm more Americanized, I grew up hanging around with a lot of black folk. And my best friends were black.
It's melting pot.
You know, I was in North Highlands for a long time. I couldn't, you know, I'd say things differently. And I got a lot of hate from both sides. I wasn't Mexican enough. Of course, I'm not black. But then, you know, back then I used to say the N-word all the time.
Yeah.
It was just who I grew up around. Once I started getting my platform, people were checking me like, hey, you don't say that. And I didn't realize that, you know, it offended people that much, you know. And I didn't really know the history of it either. I was ignorant on it.
What do you feel about other races using the N-word, especially in their music?
I really don't give a shit. I care about the meaning behind the way you use it.
Yeah.
Because I have white friends. I have Mexican friends. I have all type of friends.
Yeah.
One of my best friends is El Salvadorian.
Okay.
He don't like when I call him Mexican. It's not no straight prejudice or nothing.
No, that's how big.
But like,
homies the same.
But like, I joke with him like that. So I can't slip up. I mean, I can't get mad if he slip up and be like, fuck you, nigga.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's not, you feel me? I know he's not calling me that. I know he's not calling me a, I know when he say that, he ain't calling me a slave, and he's trying to belittle me and make me feel and make me think that he's better than me.
Like a Karen.
Yeah, no, like the way a like white person would use it. Yeah, but that's like, it's a whole difference.
You know his intentions, you know? Exactly. But I feel like what I've gotten on social media has been like a lot of people that are like, even though my intentions aren't wrong, you're still bringing awareness to something that was used negatively against my people. And so I had to take a step back and I had to, you know, obviously apologize that I'm not trying to offend nobody. You know what I mean? And I'm not trying to offend the history of black people either. But I had to take a second and be like, man, it's not about me no more. Like, even though I grew up around this and all my black homies are cool with how I talk, you know what I mean? Now it's like on a bigger spectrum and I got to respect.
More people are aware to it now.
Yeah, you know? Because there's more black people than just your homies.
Yeah.
But it took me a long time to figure that type of shit out too. Like, I'm still figuring that out. Like, I don't see nothing wrong with saying faggot. Like, I'm not homosexual. I'm not homophobic. Yeah. I have family members that's gay.
Yeah.
And we laugh and joke and we argue and I be like, shut your little faggot ass up.
Yeah, and I'm talking with you throughout the year.
And he be like, nigga, shut your little ugly short ass up. Yeah. And we laugh about it, but what I do understand now is that's me and my gay cousin and our family and our lingo.
Yeah.
But somebody else might get offended.
Somebody else that I don't know that's a homosexual might get offended.
Yeah.
So I try not to use it out in public no more.
Yeah.
Do I see anything wrong with it? No.
Yeah.
But do I understand it hurt people? Yes. Yeah. So am I going to stop saying it in public? Yeah.
Yeah. Yep, I feel that.
You're a public figure too, though, so it's different versus you saying it versus somebody that doesn't have nobody to
it's
really
just
pay
about
attention
under,
to.
It's just about understanding that.
Yeah, and respecting
that. Everybody don't feel the same way about you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm like, I don't care if a motherfucker call me short or whatever, because I am. But other people, they might get offended.
Yeah, I ain't short.
Like, what the fuck you mean? You feel me? Like, they might, you feel me? They might get offended.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
I think it's a matter of everyone just being understanding to everyone's differences. Yeah. And just having that.
Not differences. Feelings.
Feelings.
Feelings. Yeah. People gotta be more sensitive.
Like compassionate?
To how other people feel.
Yeah.
That's something that's new. Yeah, because a lot of us old school cats, we wasn't raised like that.
Yes. Like,
very cut and dry. Like, if you talked about your feelings, you was acting like a bitch. And excuse my words, because that might be offending nowadays.
No, talking about your feelings, you was in your feelings. Yeah. Get the fuck out your feelings.
Yeah, that shows weakness. You know,
in our generation, I feel like in my generation, we're all about, like, we need to start understanding each other. See, and we need to be compassionate. Kind of like that hippie movement again, you know, of just getting more in tune with yourself. Kind of dropping the wall of that ego and that pride that makes you feel like you can't feel nothing.
Yeah.
Like, but that is true. But at the same time, we come from the sticks and stones will break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Because when you in the streets and you done seen way deeper shit, there's some fucking words ain't gonna mean nothing.
Yeah.
When you done seen niggas get killed and robbed and motherfuckers on dope, and when you done seen how real life reality hit a motherfucker, words ain't gonna hurt you that bad.
Yeah.
But when a motherfucker ain't been through nothing and ain't seen nothing, they don't have a thick skin or a hard enough shell.
Yeah. Do you feel like that's why, like, especially with social media, everyone's so sensitive now? Because I feel like for people with platforms, you gotta really tread cautiously. Like, you're damned if you do. You're damned if you don't. Definitely. Everything is so
Everyone has different lenses on too. Everybody looks at the world different. Like you said,
No, I don't mean to cut you
off. No, go ahead. You're good.
But another reason everybody is so sensitive now is because social media made everybody have an opinion.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So now when you say something on social media, everybody in the world got an opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody, like 90% of them people that's going to comment and give their opinion, they don't even know you. So now when you say something, instead of motherfuckers like, so you, when you say something in this room, whether it's good or bad, these people know you,
yeah.
and mm-hmm. they know your intentions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Even if it's fucked up, yeah. they yeah. might they know. Oh, I know Tone. He probably drunk. He ain't mean it like that.
Yeah.
But when you put it on social media, it's 1,000 people that don't know you.
Yeah.
They don't know. You might could have been drunk. You might could have been going through anything.
Yeah, had a bad day.
And they construe it in their own words, too. And so what you're saying is, and yeah. stuff, you know what
and mean? They're just going to judge you from that one fucked up moment where you had a, you know what? I don't give a fuck. Fuck white people. I hate white people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like,
so I think it's important to remember then that everybody's human, regardless of a platform or not. We're all human. We're all going to make mistakes.
Everybody going to fuck up. Everybody
we're
going to
fuck up.
Sure.
You know, obviously our responsibility is a little greater.
I think everybody has, and maybe I might get backlash for saying this, everybody has some kind of racial, I won't say racist because that's actually hate, but everyone has a stereotype of people. Mexican, I know we have a certain kind of Mexicans and we have this kind of Mexicans. Every black people have this kind of black people. White people have this kind of black people. Everyone has different kinds in their cultures.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And we all have different people in our cultures that fuck things up for us. You know what I'm saying? Yep. And I think that's why it's called the stereotype.
Yeah.
So there's going to be people always look because it's going to happen. You're going to see a white lady walk and she's going to see maybe him and get nervous. Maybe he's a good guy. He might say hi, but she's probably still going to get nervous. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Same with me. I'm a big fucking dude. That little white lady's going to be scared of me.
Yep.
And you might walk by her. She's, hey, you know, or whatever. You know what I'm saying? So I think everyone's brains are just.
That makes me think because there's a lot of time being a woman. And obviously, I've got 3 kids. So, like, when I go out with my kids, I naturally, like, I'll have my pepper spray. I'll have my knife. I wonder how many, you know, because.
Razor blade in your mouth and shit.
And you just never know. I'm more vulnerable like that. You know what I mean? You see me with kids and you're like, oh, she got a purse on. I could mug her. I could, you know, I think in terms of if I was a predator, how would I view prey?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you're going to go for the easy target most of the time. So I think to myself, like, dang, I wonder how many times I made a man feel some kind of way because I went that extra mile and was here, let me make sure that this is real accessible. Or let me make sure that I'm looking over, you know, not unintentionally not wanting to because of race
or
because you're a male and I'm a female.
Like that too.
But, you know, you got to be on your toes for a little bit.
Is there any more beers back there?
Yeah,
bro?
I think there is. Can you pass the Hennessy?
I think that a lot of people aren't very educated on what racism is. I think we as the people, as America, it is a lot of racism going on, but it's also a lot of prejudice. Like, people don't understand. So what I will say is I'm prejudiced. You prejudice. Everybody has some prejudice in them.
Define prejudice for the people that don't know.
Hold on, I'm gonna do both.
Okay.
Of them. So, racism is when you don't like someone for their race or their ethnicity background.
Okay.
That's racism. Mm-hmm. Racism would mean I don't like Tone because he's Mexican. I don't know him, ain't never met him, but I don't like him because he's Mexican. Mm-hmm. That's racism. I don't like him because he's race.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if I say I don't like buff niggas, then that's prejudice.
And prejudice
is all right. That's like saying I don't fuck with broke niggas. That's okay. That's a prejudice. Everybody has prejudice. You can be prejudiced against something, but racism is what we're fighting against.
Yeah.
To not know someone and not like them or not give a fuck about them or want them to die or want to see the worst for them just because they're not the race that you are, that's racism and that's fucked up.
Yeah, that is.
But prejudice is something that you choose not to like because you don't like it.
Yeah.
Like, I don't wear Adidas. I'm prejudiced against, well, not like that, but like, not Adidas. I ain't gonna, because I wear all shoes, but I love Jordans. I really don't wear nothing. Like, I'm prejudiced because everything that ain't Jordans.
Yeah.
Like,
gotcha.
I wear some shit sometimes.
You're hitting the same point I was trying to make without explaining myself right.
Yeah.
We all have certain type of people. So, yeah, I may not like, it goes like, I don't like working with certain people because of the way they are. You asked me if I rent my studio out.
Yeah.
Because I don't like ignorant rappers in here just barking orders at a motherfucker and it's just experience. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so
exactly.
So that's true. We all have some kind of prejudice in us as human beings. It's just a mother nature because if you've been through shit, it's hard to walk around and say I love everybody. I can't see the good in everybody when I've seen so much evil.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? When I've seen the evil human being, I can't just say, hey, I got a daughter. You go hang out with any guy. You know, I can't just be that way. Yeah. I got to, hey, be careful. These fucking dudes are fucking dogs. Hey, these dudes are evil. You know, it's hard to pinpoint on who's good and bad. So it's hard to put
dang,
that.
Dang, so that's hard. It's hard to put that.
Prejudice,
you've seen some shit.
Prejudice is something you don't like. Because you don't like it because it's not your preference.
Mm-hmm.
Prejudice is something you don't like because it ain't your preference. Race is not liking someone because of the race they are.
Mm-hmm. It's like, more
and it's divided right now. It's divided than the motherfucker right now.
And you don't, and you like big dicks, your prejudice against small
little dicks. Yeah.
Ain't nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
Hey, you're not saying, real common, you know?
You're not saying that you don't like dick at all.
Yeah.
You're just saying you like a preferable size.
Yeah.
And
that's preference. Yeah, I understand. Preference and prejudice.
Prejudice is preference.
But see, right now, though, I think people right now, and we've all, I've experienced in my own way, I can never put myself in your shoes. I can't sit there and say I understand. Just like if a woman right here was raped, and I can't say I understand. I might feel like I can, but it's different. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I've been treated by police a certain way my whole life. I've been beat up. I've been victim, I guess you could say, to being pulled over just for being me, been arrested just for looking like me. So I could somewhat feel it, but it's hella divided right now more than ever. I think it's always been that way, but right now, social media, everything just really, either you're here or you're here. You know what I'm saying?
Amongst like our people? Like
in general. I don't even think it's race now, because you got black people that are straight Trump's insane. Like,
yeah.
You know what I mean? You got Mexicans that are Trump support, and I'm not just politically, but they're, well, yeah, you guys should be. We need immigration reform and all this stuff. So it's just so divided right now.
And,
with
and Biden
everything.
Said that. Biden said that stuff like, if you don't,
if you ain't
vote,
black, then you ain't. If you ain't, if you ain't,
like,
if you vote for Trump, then you ain't black. You heard him say that?
Yeah, that was
Biden.
Great.
But see, that's something that, because I listen to Charlemagne and all them, and that's something that he was basically making a point that they owe Democrats. Democrats are owed. Black people are. Supposed to vote for Democrats. That's what he was talking about. Like, they were automatically, if you're a Democrat, you're supposed to vote. And you, what makes it where, even brown people, what makes it where we're automatically going to get your vote? You know what I'm saying?
I think we're supposed to vote for
whoever. Did you know that the Democratic Party started out as the Klan?
Mm-hmm.
No, I didn't know that. Yeah, she probably know about that. It's her cup of tea.
We about it. Yeah. I like this conversation.
Yeah, you know, I know a little bit.
So you woke.
The Democratic Party started out as the Klan. They was the Democratic Party was the people fighting against the Americans.
Yeah.
That, like, that's what it was.
And, so what do you mean, like, during the Civil War, like, before,
like,
that?
The Democratic Party was like the Confederate people.
Is that right?
Like, okay. Those were the people.
Yeah.
Could, like, the Democratic Party is the anti-Americans.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Back then, America was, so when they freed the slaves, it was Lincoln and shit. It was the little war.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they fought against the Confederates, but, like, the Confederates were the Democrats.
Okay.
Like, right now.
What was Lincoln, a Democrat or Republican?
Not the Confederates, but the Democrats are the black people. I mean, not the black people, but we are the people who go against the white supremacists. Like, that's what the Democrats, like, the Democrats supposed to speak for everybody.
Speak for
the blacks, yeah.
Okay.
So back then, they were like the minorities, because America wanted to abolish slavery.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't want to. Mm-hmm. They were the
right?
people.
Okay. I didn't know that. Yeah.
They were the people. They didn't want to. They like, how dare you tell us we can't keep our slaves and shit.
Yeah.
Like,
I know the Confederates were like that. I didn't know they were like
same.
I said. Yeah,
so Democratic Party and the Confederates are the same shit.
Yeah.
It just as it went on, and the Democratic Party started getting more support from minorities, they had to distance themselves from what they was founded on.
Yeah.
Because they couldn't. It wasn't like that no more.
But
like,
a lot
they can still be that.
A lot of their beliefs, though, still are in that in the Democratic Party. A lot of where they come from is still there. I just think the illusion that they put on that they're for people like us has clouded a lot of people, if you ask me.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like they make it look good. They make it look like, yeah, we're for you. You know, we're for the people. We're for the minorities. But look at how long we've been oppressed to.
Yeah.
So exactly. how really for you are us?
I really don't know my history on that. So to speak on that subject, because then I'd make myself look like a fool. But I understand knowing growing up, being around Democrats and people that vote for that, and separating Republicans are more on business and stuff like that. So I understand me being a business person. When someone tells me, when I talk to somebody that's in politics, mm-hmm. I tell my beliefs, mm-hmm. they'd be like, oh, you got this, that's Republican of you, but you got this, that's Democratic, liberal. And it's like, I don't consider myself any of those motherfuckers.
I think it's another divide. You know what I mean? Like, I don't consider myself Democratic or Republican at all. I just feel like whoever is going to do what is best for me and the generations to come, then I support it. But so far, you know, we've been voting in, like, we're a Democratic country, and we've been voting in Democrats, but then at the same time, why are people still struggling as much then? If you're supposed to be for the people and you're supposed to help us get ahead.
I think the people in office right now, though, drew a big line. They brought it back to the old days of where it's... It's always been racial tension. It's always been like that, but I think now it's more mainstream again.
Yep.
They brought it to where they recruited the people that are actually were scared to speak up. Maybe if the guys were scared of Mexicans and blacks before and wouldn't say nothing, now they're like, you know what? Fuck you guys. We're tired of y'all.
Yeah,
you know
they got that.
You know what I think it is? So this is what I think. Mm-hmm. This is why I think the whole world is riding with this movement right now, because America been going around the world oppressing everybody, like all these other countries.
Yeah.
They been oppressing them. And us people in America, that's not white America, we still was riding with America because we was here and we didn't know to the extent what they was doing to these other people.
Yeah.
So when these other countries see America hella stupid, because when these other countries see that America is doing the same shit now in their own country to black people and Mexicans and people of minority, when they see that they doing that shit now to people in their own country, then that's when they tapped in, like, this what we've been trying to fucking tell y'all.
Yeah.
That's what they over here doing to us.
Yeah.
But y'all didn't fucking see it because they wasn't doing it to y'all at the extent of they was doing it. Like, they was doing it to us, but the extent that they're doing it to now, and it's like 100 to 1.
Not only that, too, media coverage, too. We, you know, they pick and choose what they show us on TV.
Of course.
You know what I mean? And we're sitting here thinking that we got a government and we got, you know, politicians we can trust, but really they're showing us just a biased side. Well, so when foreigners are saying, oh, this and this is happening over there, we're over here like, no.
Well,
like,
at the same time, look at this, though. Look at the business aspect of it. Yeah, media, I'm sure they have an agenda, but look at the business aspect. We need viewers. Just like us doing this show, just like him doing music, we want viewers and followers and sales, right?
Mm-hmm.
Media coverage has to have polls. They have to have ratings.
Mm-hmm.
We have to have viewers tuning into us. So they're creating little, I'm not saying creating more, but they're creating things to get more coverage.
Yeah.
Maybe they like controversy. They kick up dust. I think they try to divide on purpose to get people to tune in. They love these pandemics. They love this shit going on with Trump. They love, you know how many people are watching CNN that never watched CNN before? Yeah. That's just turned into advertisement dollars like a motherfucker.
But
you know what
in
I'm
terms
saying?
Of generations.
Advertising dollars at an all-time high right now.
In terms of generations to come, though, from a business aspect, it looks like a good move, right? But in terms of your kids, my kids, and your kids, what does that do for them? So if you're just, if you're choosing what to you know, show, and you're doing it for revenue, there's no purpose behind it then.
Yeah,
so
then it's hard to see. People just glue. People just watch
and
believe.
To what extent?
Just like people watch anything, just like we talked earlier with the shit that happened in Chicago. People watch Shade Room and they believe it because Shade Room posted it.
Yeah.
People just watch and believe. And then you got the woke people, you got the conspiracies, you got everyone. Everyone's going to have their opinion on no matter what. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, shit's always been fucked up. I think now is actually making a change, though.
Yeah.
Because
definitely.
All the shit that happened in the past, people protesting now, even if the motherfucker's cop is still racist, right?
Mm-hmm.
Still, he hates black people, hates Mexicans. You know, look at those fucking cholos. Just get them. They're going to think, like, fuck, maybe we shouldn't go whoop their ass and roll on them, and they might start thinking.
They'll think twice.
So even if it's that case, we might not change their heart, we'll change their mind, where it might save somebody's life. It might save my kid's life, your kid's life. Because damn, we can't just go whoop this motherfucker's ass right now. Someone might be watching and the whole world's gonna get burned down if I kill this kid. You know what I'm saying?
Bro, the only way we get change And the only reason we get change is when America gets scared.
True that.
That's like the whole world, like it just makes them uncomfortable. The whole world is riding with this Black Lives Matter shit right now. Like they're fucking scared, bro. America is not, I don't give a fuck how big they think they is. America ain't big enough to be the little sole country to go against the whole world.
Yeah, that's very true.
Yeah.
They can go against another country one at a time.
Yeah.
But they can't be by themselves and go against the whole fucking world by themselves.
Yeah. And I think we're the most hated anyways from all the other countries.
We are the most hated.
What's fucked up too is that America turned on their own people. On people like us who have built America.
America.
You turned on your own people. So that 1%, you think that you could really combat, like you said, the world.
Yeah. America, number one thing of being scared of is an uprise. And right now, they have an uprise. And what I mean by an uprise is like Cuba. Like Castro had an army of, it was just this.
Mm-hmm.
It was just protesters and shit.
Mm-hmm.
And they ran in the fucking cap. They ran in the Cuban White House or whatever.
Yeah.
And pushed the government out and took over.
Like a revolution.
But the thing is, like a revolution. But the thing is, America, like not America backed Batista and Castro. America backed both. What everybody don't know, but Castro went back on his word. America didn't give a fuck who won. They backed both. America thought if Castro won, then he was gonna still fuck with them. But he changed his shit because he like fuck y'all. Y'all hella boosie. Y'all go back on y'all word and double cross motherfuckers all the time.
Yeah.
Dish y'all payback.
Yeah.
But like, just say one of these other countries or say all these other countries start funding Black Lives Matter.
Mm-hmm.
When I mean fund, I mean by money. Like, just say Russia donate $1 billion to Black Lives Matter.
Yeah.
Or 10 billion. Or these, you feel me? Like, that's what, like, Castro didn't have no fucking money to buy all them people guns and grenades and all that shit.
America gave it to him?
We gave them to
same
him.
Same with Al-Qaeda, though.
Yeah, same shit, We gave them to him. That's what America's scared of right now.
America's
what if one of these countries decide, what if one of these countries decide to arm Black Lives Matter? Or what if they all get together?
That would cause another civil war, and it'd be a fight. You know what I'm saying?
I think we take back our control, and I think the way we are as people too, I feel like we're pretty grounded people.
Yeah. But they back against the wall right now because it's 1 against 10.
I tell you what, they say violence. The people that are uncomfortable, this is not the way to do it. Violence doesn't solve nothing. Yeah. But if violence didn't solve nothing, why would they have wars?
Exactly.
Solves everything.
Why would they have wars? Why would we go to war if violence never solved nothing?
Why would they use violence against us to control us and oppress us for all these years? If violence didn't work,
it makes them uncomfortable.
Who wins a war?
The person that fucking kills the most motherfuckers.
The person that insinuates the most violence.
Yeah.
Period.
That's crazy. And you know what's crazy is a lot of people don't even have the capacity to like understand it from a logical standpoint like that. You know what I mean? A lot of people that are like, no, peace, love, and happiness, and this isn't the way.
That'd be nice to have.
In an ideal world.
But I want peace too. If I go. See,
that's not the war we're fighting, though.
Some people use against us against me. All right, I grew up gangbanging.
Mm-hmm.
And in our culture, Mexicans, there's been gangbanging out in California, right?
Yeah.
I grew up doing certain things. I'm a felon. I have a record. I understand that. But I've evolved into a grown man. I have a family. I have businesses. I pay taxes. I'm a citizen now. You know what I'm saying? I've evolved. That a lot of people are not given that chance to because they're going to. And I still get stereotyped. If I drive, I got tattoos. I got, you know, my hair. I wear my, wherever I dress. Yeah. They're going to say you're a gang member. You look the way you look. But I'm a business owner. I'm an actual citizen. So they don't give us a chance to better ourselves. So people use that. What I'm saying is, well, he got killed because go look at, like, if I got smoked right now, they're going to say he had a record. He had this. He did this. He had that in his history. They're going to pull up all my old pictures, throwing up gang signs and all this shit. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And they justify that because of that.
That's because we also live in a world where people, you know, if you want to evolve and you want to grow and if you want to, you know, learn from your mistakes, you're looked at as less. But that comes from the conditioning that I feel like the world that we grew up in, America.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? you can't get ahead. You're supposed to stay less.
But that's what I'm saying. They're going to justify it. So if Stalin got killed today by the police, he's like, in a Maserati, he's doing good, he gets smoked, they're going to be like, well, listen to him rapping about police and this and that. They're going to find every excuse to paint him less as a human because of that. Yeah. You know
that
what I'm saying?
That ain't going to happen, though, because I was finna speak on that before you said that. That's not going to happen because I was having this conversation with somebody, with my homie the other day. So whenever I get pulled over by the police, if they come nice and they just want license, registration, and we just do it cordially, but if they come hostile or whatever, I make sure I tell them, I'm such and such rapper, woo, 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 I'm rich as fuck, I pay your taxes, you kill me, it's over, period. You know who, listen, go Google me before you kill me. Because if you kill me, they're going to burn this fucking city down.
Yeah. But what about the people that don't got your status, though? You know what I mean? So then what do they do?
In that life of in that moment of my life and death, I can't think about that right now.
Yeah.
But I was having a conversation with someone, and they was asking me, why you do that? I was like, because he going to think twice about killing someone who he thinks is a public figure.
Yeah, and got the influence.
You feel me?
That can start
up. He going to think twice. He might like, I could be lying. Everybody should do this. They don't know. They not going to do it right now.
Yeah.
But run your Jerry.
Yeah, that's true.
We from the ghetto, nigga. Run your Jerry. Yeah. I went to Vegas one time, nigga. I went to Vegas one time for a weekend. Got me a motherfucking limo, nigga. And told them, nigga, that I was a movie producer.
No way, you got away with it.
You could be wherever you want to be in Vegas.
Yeah, for real.
You could be wherever you want to be in Vegas.
Shit, I'm about to be a millionaire when I go to Vegas.
You see the fake J-Lo I took a picture with?
Look.
No.
Everyone thought I was a J-Lo at the Empire Party.
You could be wherever you want to be in Vegas on that day.
Hey, I haven't been to Vegas yet, so we'll see when I get there. We'll see who I'm going to be when I get there.
Yeah, nah, but
I make sure that
they believe they think you're somebody, they're going to act different.
Exactly.
That's crazy.
But you know what? Now, but this is what I'm saying. You could get away with that before. But right now, even you ask that. What if someone doesn't have your stature? Now, somebody saying that anyways, be like, there's cameras everywhere. Someone say, you fuck up, you're going to be watched. They're going to think now. They don't want to be like, these cops, I don't know if they're going to get convicted or whatnot, but they still sitting in jail right now, county jail, finding cases like everyone else.
Yeah.
They locked up. Now, most cops are going to, they're going to be walking on eggshells, and I'm not gonna just sit there because I don't want to be one of those dudes. I know policemen that I grew up with that became cops, and they're actually cool dudes. I go to the gym and I see these dudes, and they cool people. I'm not gonna sit there and say all cops are like that because that would be stereotype. But it goes back to saying I seen Chris Rock make a post. You can't have bad apples in that profession.
Yeah,
just like being a pilot.
Yeah, I seen that too.
Just like being a pilot, you can't say well, maybe some planes might land, but only a few crash. Now you can't have that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And they are fucking it up for everybody. But for the ones that are fucked up, because I remember being treated like that, pulled over just by how I look, yanked out. You know what I mean? They're gonna think about that. You know, if I kill this dude or if I beat his ass, I'm probably gonna end up in the fucking cell.
Yeah, well,
treated for their account. They're accountable for their own actions now. You feel
me? It's a time. Definitely, we're living in a time of change. You know, I think it's very hopeful time, even though it's
fucked
crazy
up that,
right now.
It's fucked up that it had to happen, you know, George Floyd, but I feel like sometimes it's a sacrifice. Not say a sacrifice. Some things need to happen for change.
Yeah.
Otherwise, things can get swept under the rug. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And it's like, you know what? Fuck it, man. These motherfuckers been killing. They've been murderers. They've been gangsters. They've been getting away with it. You know what I mean? So it's time they deal with their own fucking actions. You know what I'm saying?
When I came up with that thought, I was thinking of, what do police don't want? Like, what do the country don't want? What they don't want is what's going on right now.
Yeah. Lose control.
Or their unity of people, too. I feel like that's why there's so much stuff on the media still continuous. Like, we're continuously getting fed shit that's supposed to divide us. But what's happening is a lot of us are realizing that, and we're trying to stand together. And I think when the masses stand together and we're in unity...
Game over. I seen even the U.S. What are they saying? What's it called?
The National Guard.
I seen even National Guard dudes in there cheering with the protesters. Mm-hmm. You seen that on the World Star?
They kneel too.
Yeah. So it's even divided. Man, just another thing. I was watching World Star. You seen that?
Oh, they just left out of L.A. too.
The National Guard.
They left on their own to show peace. Nice,
wow, nice. That's powerful
Trump,
right there.
Trump didn't tell them to go.
That's powerful.
They left on their own to show peace. Like the L.A. governor or whatever, he got in whatever, the general or the national. They did that on their own.
I think they Trump made their point. Smart.
Trump didn't order
tear
that
this bitch. We gonna tear this bitch down because we can, and then we'll be peaceful and we could get by now with our message. I like how that was done. Cause
they like, look, if y'all don't fuck nothing up no more, we'll leave. Yeah. Because we're not here to hurt y'all.
Yeah.
We're just here to protect the innocent.
So
innocents.
If they don't convict, if these guys get out, what do you think is gonna happen?
Oh, it's over.
It's gonna go down again. If these guys don't get convicted and they say slap on the wrist.
Oh yeah, there's no way. There's no way that.
Because that same thing.
Well,
it got worse with Rodney King, right? The cops got arrested.
If America's smart, you'll learn from Rodney King. You know what I mean? But what worries me is that are they going to try to be more strategic?
It's not smart. It's power. Look at fucking Epstein. You watch that documentary on Epstein?
My God, I
you watch
did.
That shit?
That
you seen
crazy.
That yet?
Yeah.
That motherfucker, look how much shit he was able to get away with because of his ass
money
and power.
Money runs
with,
you know?
Yeah, yeah. All right, just take a quick little break.
Except for like kids, places like Chuck E. Cheese and shit like that. But the restaurants open.
They need to open this motherfucker up, man. I think. Yeah, they hurt. They supposed malls to be opening
open.
Everything. They need to open a
open?
Gym.
Yeah,
I know Yuba City opened up before everybody.
I think Arden Mall opened up too, but there was some bullshit. Yeah, there was some.
They had
some
a
stuff
fire.
That happened.
They had a fucking Royal Rumble.
Is that
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I seen it.
So they closed down because of that? I mean, what's the fight? Was
I feel,
it a,
no,
was
I feel
a,
like they tried to make it about everything that's going on with the protests, yeah. But from like just on a personal aspect, knowing personal people,
no,
it was it have nothing.
They
to do with
did
that.
The Royal Rumble and they closed it down because they like. They don't want motherfuckers to loot.
Oh, not super saying.
Yeah.
Hey, you know what? I'm a business owner too, and I seen they hit Cookies. They hit Burner Spot, and you know he had his opinion, and I understand. You know when you got money, yeah. Hey, it's, but I ain't gonna lie, bro. I'm still a G from the streets. Like I understand. I'm with the movement and all that. But if you run up in my spot, I'm gonna let your ass have it. I don't give a fuck. Like, hey, I'll be out there. Respect, bro. Go hit the next man's spot. Go hit the police station. Don't hit my business, bro. I work hard for this shit.
It's the matter of the fact is, y'all know Burner with the culture. See, that's the bullshit.
Exactly. Yeah.
You like don't. Why would you loot his shit? He with the culture, and he's for the culture.
That was
like,
fucked up too, though.
Like that's the shit that they're talking about. Like small businesses, black owned businesses, minority owned businesses. Like,
but did you
don't do. But see, that's when they're just there. They're not there for George Floyd.
Yeah.
They're just there to get free shit.
Yeah.
And those are the people that you feel like you.
Yeah.
Those are the people that you can shoot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it diminishes the purpose.
Yeah.
That we're trying to make.
But
when we have motherfuckers out there that's just there for free shit.
Yeah. You see the videos that they were putting like brick pallets.
Yeah, that's Antifa motherfuckers.
Yeah, planting shit everywhere. I feel like a lot of it too is strategic.
Yeah, of course.
And you know, if one person does it, boom, hella sheep are gonna follow.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
A lot of the looters, looter, whatever the fuck they call, a lot of them was
looters.
White. I seen a video in Florida, nigga, where they running out the Gap, bust the window, they running out the Gap on the Shore Drive or whatever that drive or whatever. And the officer is just so nonchalant.
He's letting it happen. I seen that.
He ain't pull out his gun.
They're talking. They're
he ain't try
it.
To. He ain't try to grab
it.
Nobody.
That's crazy.
He ain't try to do. Yeah. If them was black people running out that store, he would have been picking their ass off like birds. Nigga.
I seen a video pew, of a black owned business pew. Protecting their business, and they called the cops. Hey, come help us. And the police came and hemmed them up and let the dudes get away.
Are you for real?
But I seen Fab was on live and I got a glimpse of it because I was kind of, you know, he's out there in Oakland. He's right there on Broadway. He's right next to Cookies. They busted out Cookies' windows are there on Broadway. They broke his windows, but I didn't think they ran up in it. You know what I'm saying? But still,
windows.
He was like, look at these motherfuckers. Ain't nobody from, this is people coming from Concord and outside areas coming to fuck up their hood. You know what I mean? So yeah, it is fucked up to pinpoint, and it's hard to say, look, I stand with y'all, but if you run up in my spot, doesn't mean I'm against you.
Yeah.
I'm protecting my own.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Hey, thankfully, in Sacramento, too, it's been a lot. Like, my homegirl, she was just out at the protest yesterday, and she said that even the energy in the atmosphere, she was like, it's all love. Like, you could look at each other and just know, like, we're all here.
I seen it's peaceful as fuck now.
And I was like, man, that for her to tell me that really moved me, because I was like, that's cool.
Yeah.
It's cool to know that we got people that just with energy can come together and change the whole atmosphere.
Like, with that loot and shit, like, if you, like, like he said, like they bust out the windows in Berkeley and Fab. Like these motherfuckers ain't even from here. Whoop. Like if you're that in tuned and you're that knowledgeable, then you would know Burner and Fab is for the culture.
Yeah.
So you wouldn't do that shit.
Yeah.
Yep.
So that's you're doing it. You're doing it just to do it. And that's wrong. And that's when you get fucked up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like you're not like, you're like, that's cool. No, like real, like you walk past, they cool. I don't know who them is. I ain't never known them to support. Last time I went in there, that bitch told me hurry up and buy.
Hurry up and buy. But see,
break all the shit. Yeah. You feel me? Like they not doing it like that.
Yeah. But Burn, this is what I'm saying. Burn was so, in my opinion, so stand up that he took that sacrifice.
Cause he's
that's what I'm saying. He was just like
over and over.
Of course. And it's easier. I'm not saying it's easier because your beliefs, it's not about money at that point. You know, it's fucked up. Our shit got fucked up. But shit needs to go the way it needs to go.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But like I said, for small business guys that maybe have their last dollar into their business and they come from the same environment as these people, why the fuck? And I posted something like that and I had a little backlash like, well, fuck that. Everybody needs to burn this motherfucker down.
Yeah.
Like, you know, so everyone has their opinions. You know what I'm saying? Like,
for me too, you know, even me and my man, we had a conversation about this and we were like, man, so we predominantly lived in downtown Sacramento before we bought our house. Yeah. So it just so happens the day that we moved out, everyone started looting. And he's real protective of his family. So he was like, I get that people are for the movement, but if they come start freaking breaking our windows, trying to get in our car, like, he's going to practice his Second Amendment, right? You know what I mean?
Just like any one of us would.
And, you know, I'm the one that's more like love, peace, and happiness, but I understood it because the last thing I want, my kids are in this damn car. When it comes to protecting my kids, there's nothing I won't do.
Nothing.
You know, so I understood it on that level. I think people need to understand that too. You gotta find a balance. Protect yours.
You know, you're representing for something, but doesn't mean you need to need to protect yours at all times. Because like I said, you don't know that person's intentions. That person busting in your shit might not give a fuck about anything that's going on but his self greed. You feel me?
Yeah.
Those are just stupid, idiot people just doing dumb shit because they can at the point
taking
in time
advantage
of the moment.
Yeah.
In six, when all this shit died down in 6 months, and they go back and check all the cameras.
They all getting hit. They starting to get hit now.
All you looters is finna go to jail, and y'all finna get a hell of time for terrorist acts.
Yep.
Yeah.
See, the thing is, you have to pick and choose your battles. Yeah. When bank robbers rob banks, they just don't go rob any bank. They go rob the most one that's capable of getting a fucking way with. Mm-hmm. They scope out banks and they say, okay, this one got 5 security guards. This one only got 2 security guards.
Mm-hmm.
This one got 5 security guards and they ain't too big. They niggas look like they can handle somebody. They look like they can run.
I might get my ass. Yeah.
This motherfucker got 2 fat ass niggas sitting outside in chairs in the front eating donuts. Mm-hmm. Like, who you gonna hit?
Yeah.
Like, pick and choose your battles.
Yeah. A part of me, though, I mean, not to play devil's advocate, a part of me, though, like from some of the videos that I saw and I did see that it wasn't just white people, it was also minorities. I kind of feel like when you starve somebody so much, at what point does their hunger take over them?
Of course.
At what point does that animal instinctual instinct to survive
but
overpower?
I think that's different because it's going back to being opportunist, and I agree with that.
Yeah.
Hey, fuck it. We've been broke. We've been the pandemic shut down my business for 3 months. I don't know. I'm gonna pay bills, and there's an opportunity.
Yeah.
And I understand that you gotta do what you gotta do, but sometimes it's like you said. Then now all of a sudden they got me on camera. They tracked my phone that I was in. My GPS put me here at this time, and there all this evidence against me. Now I got to go get a $5,000 lawyer. Now I'm going to go to jail for 18 months. And you know, goes back to plotting. You got to think of the future. It doesn't mean you're going to get away with it. It's just like the pandemic. We still got to pay our fucking bills. You know what I'm saying? They don't give a fuck at the end
of the
day.
There's always consequences to your actions.
But yeah, man. So, I was glad we got to touch on some good subjects, man. And like I said, man, there is a division right now between a lot of people and, I'm standing my ground with representing what I represent, and I'm still standing with you know, I grew up around a lot of black people. I was in the mixed neighborhood, man. I grew up here in Antioch, and it's always been mixed, you know. Anybody knows Antioch, I was running around Sycamore and Buchanan and all that, and it was black and brown. Mm-hmm. I started doing music when I first started rapping. My first album, I was working with the Jack and Huss and Wax. TLs. Yeah, but I'm just saying though, I've always fucked with different cultures. So it's like it's I see people now trying to divide us. You know what I mean? I have my own people in my DM. Well, look what they're doing to the paleteros and the corn mm-hmm. ladies and mm-hmm. stuff like that. And I'm like, that's just, bro. Things happen. You can't just. Like Same it's point. Like highlights. It's like yeah. just gonna highlight certain things and say this is how it is. You know
but
what I'm
I do
saying?
Agree that what's going on right now, we should have did this for them kids that was in them concentration camps.
Yeah, appreciate Amen. That, man. I agree with yeah, that. Amen. I think we were protesting and it should have went harder. And I don't think it was. I think it takes to get to the next level where people make enough noise. Mm-hmm. Just like people being like, killed by the cops long enough and people make enough noise.
If one of those. Children yeah. would have died in the concentration camp.
I think they have,
camp.
Bro. I think they have.
Yeah, children. They have.
But it's not. Yeah. But we don't know. Yeah. Exactly. Like they don't yeah, they're not broadcasting. It's not yeah. on the. Like somebody said, if they didn't catch that George Floyd shit on camera, none of this should have been going
it wouldn't,
on.
It wouldn't yeah. happen.
None of this should have been yeah. going on. Like we seen the kids in the concentration camps. But if they would have made like the new, like you said, the news control everything. Mm-hmm. If the news would have made it. See, the thing, see, it's always just like one hungry ass reporter that's trying mm-hmm. to get the new, mm-hmm. the nigga from Minnesota who broke the George Floyd shit, the first news nigga, like, yeah. who was like, oh my God, cops killed, he probably getting death threats and all.
Oh, yeah.
yeah.
But you know what? Oh, he gonna get a bigger job out of Minnesota.
Yeah.
yeah.
You feel
yeah.
me? Like, it's yeah. all about.
It needs to be. Yeah.
Well,
who's willing?
Got
to,
the balls and the nuts. Yeah.
Who's got
go
the
there?
Balls and yeah. and like you said, kids were dying in that. All it took was one reporter to be like, a 6-year-old kid died in a concentration camp in such and such and such from lack of food and lack of water and such and such and such and such.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But
the
they
crazy
never
part is,
did that.
We've had some reporters that do go and have like went to. Press meetings and at the you know White House and whatnot. This new wave though that heck of kids have been coming out that they've been sexually assaulted by the officials.
Yeah, I believe.
What's up
yeah.
with that? Like yeah. we need. I mean,
that's a whole other battle.
I need a reporter with balls to
yeah, no, I think it's
highlight
a whole other
that
battle.
Because
that is fucked up. Because like I said, no one will realize until they get their kid snatched and say you're going here and you're
yeah.
going
yeah,
there,
yep.
and then they
you
will
get
feel
your
that.
Kid, you know, yeah. talking to your kid, and they tell you, yeah, so and so raped me, so and so touched me. Yeah. I can't even.
And a lot of the people
imagine.
Are coming out here because of their fucked up conditions. Like people don't know, like you get killed speaking up like this in other countries.
Yeah.
If we had this show in another country talk like this, we'd be fucking walked out here. Our heads would get cut off.
You know what's fucking crazy? So I was watching Law and Order. Not too long ago. So Law and Order has a episode to where the director of the FBI, mm-hmm. his daughter, was hanging out with her Mexican friends or whatever,
mm-hmm.
and they hit them, ice hit them, and they took his daughter.
Mm-hmm.
Oh shit!
And he got his daughter back in 2 days. And the daughter was like, Dad, what about my friends? Like, can we go get them? Whoop, whoop, whoop. And he was like, I can't do nothing about it. Like yeah. it's just like white privilege at its finest. Yeah. Like, it's just like, she like, Dad, like, but you have to like, you have to go get my friends. Like, and he like, there's nothing I can do about it. Like,
yeah. Yeah. They ain't my kids. They don't got a dad
like those,
me.
Like, those are my kids. Like. Like, they're not American. Like, those aren't my kids. They're not American. Like,
damn.
And it was just so fucked up. Like, but all Law and Order shows be based on real events.
Yeah.
You know that?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that shit really happened.
Yeah. It's sad.
No, and you know, like you said, because we ain't seen it, they ain't broadcasting it. We don't know
yeah.
what the fuck they're
yeah,
going through. The pain, all that shit.
I think we need. Go ahead.
Go ahead. Yeah. Nah, it is fucked up to think about it because then it's like, until it's brought to the table, people won't even really elaborate on it.
Yeah.
You know.
I think we just need more people to stand up for what's right. not stand up for what's convenient.
That's we need leaders built right now, man. We need leaders, man. And even the power, Stylin, you got a lot of power. You're a public figure. You got people that fuck with you. You're a legend in the Bay Area. I got a lot of followers and people that fuck with me. We got people like us to come together. You know, even
you're a legend in the Bay too. The Bay, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Nigga, you a legend in the Bay too.
And, but it takes people like us to come together. You know, she's coming up. She's got a nice following, man. You know, we're able to breed leaders now, bro. Yeah. We're able to, and I don't know if you feel the same way I do, because I've evolved a lot. It goes back to where I changed. But when I started rapping, bro, all I was talking about was shooting motherfuckers. That's my mentality. All I was talking about was sliding. I was talking about was selling dope. My whole first album, everything was guns and shooting and riding and putting in work. You know what I'm saying? And glorifying it. But, and I've had people tell me, hey, homie, I remember one individual told me this, and it kind of tripped, sparked something. He's like, hey, homie, I went to the pen because of you. The fuck you mean? He goes, yeah, bro, I went to prison. I was bumping your shit hard, bro. I went out riding because you had me so pumped. I went out sliding. You know what I mean? Yeah. And it's like, and to and you go
that's
back
not
and
the look, message you want to send.
You go back and look at the numbers we've had, the albums we sold, the numbers, whatever, and how many people have we influenced to do that? And whatever, that's what some people want to do. They want to profit off it. To me, it's like it's beyond money. I'm good. I've been making my dough. Now it's about purpose. I don't want to send this youngster on a mission. This little kid might be like me, confused, and he look up to me so much, and I told him to go get a gun and shoot that motherfucker, and that's what he did. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So that shit changed my perspective now on how to use my small platform, whatever I have, to help influence people. I want to build leaders. I don't tell people, go change your life, son, be a square. Nah, man, be a leader, be a boss. Evolving to something bigger than what you think you have to be.
I agree. I like
we
that.
We have that power, hell bro. Yeah. We have you're that perfect. Power,
you're
bro.
You're absolutely right.
You know what I'm saying? People listen to us. People listen to your music and soak up your every word you say.
Yeah, and a lot of kids are out here without a dad, without a male influence that's older than them. You know what I mean? Yeah. So when they hear your music and when you guys are moving them emotionally, when they're in a dark place, I know just growing up, I used to listen to you and the Jacka. Yeah. The Jacka, I cried when he died because he got me through my toughest times in high
Everybody
school.
Everybody did.
You know what I mean?
And Jack was a friend of mine, too. He's from my age. He was on my first album on a bunch of songs.
You guys are there in an emotional way for a lot of these young men that are lost. So if you guys can be that example, you lead by example, we're gonna breed a whole generation of leaders.
When you rap, do you realize that sometimes when you're writing? Because I know, like me, when I used to write, I'm just like, yeah, I'm just gonna just gas this motherfucker, try to come as hard as I can and sound. I know rap, sometimes we want to boss ourselves. We talk the truth, but it's like, let me just come amplify as hard it. As I can. You know, I'm not amplified, just like, I'm gonna come out as gangster as I can. You know what I'm saying? And that's just like, that's what music is. But sometimes now I start writing, I have to dumb myself down sometimes and bring it down because I'm like, I don't want to put that out there now. You know what I'm saying? It's starting to hit me more now as I'm older. And it may not be as good as, it might not be where people want to hear sometimes. I don't know. Yeah. Do you ever feel like that now when you're writing your music? Like, I got to kind of be more choosing on what I'm putting out there?
I went through that, like still going through that. I'm not quite where you at yet, but I can say that when I was a kid, when I was in the sixth grade, I used to write movies.
Okay.
Like, literally, like, my teacher did a whole press conference with my mom and shit, like, he's so smart. Like, he writes these 16, 20, 30-page movies at 12 years old, to where I know he has a future somewhere in something, but... Mm-hmm. He won't do his work. Like, I need him to get his work. So I'm a writer, first of all. So when I write music, say I rap about, like, I've never been the rapper that rapped about glorifying murder and just killing. Like, it was cool to be a serial killer.
Yeah. Now, you're good at painting pictures.
If I ever rapped about killing someone, it was about protecting yourself, or someone did something to you, or it was just never on no, just I'm just out to murder, kill, and just be the biggest murderer in the world. Mm-hmm. Like, so I never went through that to where, like, the motherfucker would be like, if a motherfucker would just say they shot somebody over a Jay Stylin song or something, they'd be like, yeah, bro. Like, you said in your song that you warned a nigga the third time.
Yeah.
You feel me? Like, I told you leave me alone once. I told you leave me alone twice. Like, mm-hmm. what am I supposed to do the third time?
True that, yeah.
Like, when I rap about violence or whatever, I always make sure that I let the audience know it's back against the wall. This is to protect myself. This is survival mm-hmm. in the life that we living in. Mm-hmm. You feel me? I ain't never glorified murder. Just like, I'm a serial killer. Yeah.
Like most
yeah.
rappers.
Yeah. I had 20 bodies yesterday. Yeah.
Put your conscious. So that's what I was asking. You're conscious about the message you're putting out now.
Yes.
Because
yes.
some people don't. I never was, though. Like I said, so that's evolving into
artists. I always was conscious yeah. because I never wanted to send the wrong message. Like the worst thing a person can be is misconstrued. Mm-hmm. Like you always, when even if a motherfucker don't know you and they listen to your raps, you expect them to get what you're trying to put out.
Yeah.
You feel me? And mm-hmm. and I've been luckily to have my fans to understand and get exactly what I was putting out.
Yeah.
You feel me? Like,
yeah, no, it's an art. The way you paint your picture, you do that right. A lot of people yeah. can't. You able
thank
to?
You,
yeah,
thank you,
yeah,
bro.
No, for definitely. Sure. Yeah.
Like, cause I rap about killing, but I never glorified it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
That's the
like,
point.
I've rapped about committing murders and having nightmares about it. Yeah. You mm-hmm. feel me? Like mm-hmm.
the real shit that comes
just
with it.
Like, yeah, just like let, like yeah, like you once you do that,
it goes on.
Like once you do that, it ain't over, bro.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like that shit might haunt you for the rest of your life. Like. Yeah. You feel me?
That's one thing I do. I talk about the past tense stuff. This is what happens. It's reality. You can't. It's like reporting what happens in your life, and then I try to talk about the consequences and the reactions of it. It ain't cool burying your homeboys. It ain't cool burying your best friend. It ain't cool seeing your best friend's mom shedding tears, knowing that you guys are out here thugging together, and you might be a reason why he's in that yeah. box. You know what I'm saying? Like when you start feeling certain things, I really feel like this life has humbled me. That's why yeah. I don't put on that out here trying to be the fucking super ultimate dude, gangbanging ass motherfucker. I'll kill anybody. I don't care about that persona no more. This life has humbled me, bro. Now, don't get me wrong. I still hold my ground by any means, but I don't feel like that. I feel like a lot of people ain't been humbled yet.
Because yeah.
Some people are just stupid. They don't get it. They're going to keep getting, they're yeah. going to keep going through until they end up in prison the rest of life or getting killed. You know
it
what I'm saying?
It'd just be hella hard for some people to just see the bigger picture.
And to be true self-aware.
Like, yeah. Yeah.
You know, to be able to know yourself on a level and understand yourself on a level that you are understanding the impact that you're having on people other than who yourself.
That's what I'm saying.
You know
being
I mean?
Conscious on like, what you're putting out the energy.
My biggest fear is my children growing up without a father.
Yeah.
Like, that's
mine too.
My biggest fear.
Mine too.
And that's not a fear from me getting shot. Like that's a whole part of me stop eating beef.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, I want to be healthy and live for my kids.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Like and not get shot, too.
Yeah, but I'm saying, though, it's just, yeah. it just not like a just being scared of the street shit.
Yeah.
Nigga, it's a being scared of everything.
Cancer,
yeah.
too.
Yeah, yeah it's a being scared of everything.
Oh, yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
You like, went deeper with it. You didn't.
I didn't call. I didn't call the doctors twice and thought I had COVID. They're like, "Well, do you have a fever? Do you have this? Do you have this? Do you have this?"
I'm like, "No." Sick. I was like, "Bro, I think we're finna have to cancel Sunday."
They're like, "Well, call us when you do then." Yeah, he hit me. He like, "Oh, bro." I'm like, "Nah, bro. I got food poisoning. I'll be good by Sunday."
Yeah.
He hit me like, "Oh, bro. You woo woo." I'm like, "Nah, I'm good. That's that 24-hour thing."
You know what made me more realize I was conscious? My last show I did. Normally I would go and I would chill and I like to embrace the love. I like to meet people. So I love doing that with my fans and my followers. But lately, like my last show, it's the first time where, hey, all right, we're pulling up, we're getting in on stage, doing our thing. Security in the car was waiting, and when I'm done, I'm out, boom.
Yeah.
Cause there were certain times I was going, like certain things was going through my head, like you don't know, you start feeling the love and hate.
Mm-hmm. I do that all the time, but the thing is, like with that type of shit, you gotta feel the crowd vibes.
Yeah, now the crowd was cool, but you don't know who's, you don't know, there's a lot of people that, when you start getting a lot of love, there's a lot of people that hate.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of us overlook that.
And it's masked with love.
Yeah, so like you can see the crowd going crazy,
mm-hmm.
but what's them motherfuckers that been hating in the sideline watching? Hey, he pulling up in that car. Yeah, you know what I mean? So I'm thinking maybe that's the paranoia in me, but my boy Woody said paranoia is overrated. It could save your life. Yep. I'd rather be extra paranoid than be one of these dudes that just sloppy, walk out drunk, kicking after my show on the sideline and get smoked by some punk-ass hater that just mad I didn't respond to his DM or something. I don't know, you know what I'm saying? So, yeah, no, I'm noticing changes in me getting older, and I know this is not cool because the times change. Look at, I seen earlier, I hate bringing this dude up, but I seen fucking Akon and 6ix9ine doing a song together. They just remade Locked Up number 2. Do you see this shit on Worldstar today?
Yeah, I seen that.
Man, that, it, to me, it's like I'm definitely from a different era. I'm seeing times change, and I'm trying to adapt, but adapting to people that are cooperating with law enforcement, that glorifying being locked up. Like, he could have changed that song to saying I'm PC and then whatever, and it would have been cool. But he,
that shit is horrible, but I understand. Akon ain't had a hit since.
You need that?
Hey, that's what my man said. My man was like, Akon's hella
so
smart.
So, he.
Man,
Akon is hella rich. Akon is hella rich. That's true. But how long is that money gonna keep flowing in? I mean, I don't know. But the only way I see a black African from Africa who's so highly on his blackness and his pride do a song with a Mexican snitch is for the money. I can't see no other reason.
Well, I think everyone's in that.
I can't see no other reason.
That self-preservation mode. And I think each human got that self-preservation mode. At some point, you're like, man, well, what is my name? What do I got to do to keep my name keep going? To keep my status keep going? There's like you said, Akon ain't had a hit in a minute.
But it ain't a minute. He's hadn't had a hit in over 10 years. So
a long minute.
But the thing is, when do standing for something mean something? I mean, he a snitch. He didn't snitch on you, okay? Like, whatever you didn't condone. But on that note, just say you're not a perfect person. Say Akon is 6ix9ine just kicking it one night and they run a train on the bitch or whatever, and anything happened, and then he like, yep, he raped that bitch. Akon, he did it. He raped her. I was there. He raped her. Like, you feel me? Like, how does that much money make you not scared to gamble with a person like that?
There's not a dollar amount.
That's what I'm saying. How can money make you not scared to gamble with a person like that? Like,
so it goes back. Someone like me, I ain't rich by any means.
I just lost hella respect for Akon.
Straight hella respect. But I ain't a rich dude, but I've touched a lot of money. I feel that's a lot of money to me, you know, to a multimillionaire like this chump change. But I'm sure you've touched your share amount of money. So when you have money and you've been around it, certain things don't matter. Like you could give me $3 million cash right now, and I could have $10 million in the bank. But if I'm not happy and I don't have integrity, I can't look at myself. Rich people kill themselves all the time. People with the money doesn't mean happiness.
Jim Carrey said, "I wish everybody in the fucking world could become millionaires so they could see that that's not the answer."
Not the answer, man.
See, I haven't touched money like either one of you guys, and still, just on a moral aspect, on just who I am and the code that I live by and the morals that I believe in and how I was raised, there is no amount of money that could ever switch me from what I believe in and straight what up. I feel like you
should. I'm gonna earn that money another way.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm gonna hustle. I'm gonna get that money a whole another way. I don't need to fucking do a song with a rat.
I can't understand Akon's, you know, I mean, I can understand it, but at the same time, on a moral level, I just don't understand.
I understand it. 6ix9ine, and I don't blame him. Why is he gonna do this? Roll down? I don't blame him. He did what he did. He's probably got a management team telling him, look, you need to capitalize off this. Go wear a weave, color it, look even extra crazier. Oh my God, dude, make as much noise as you can, because we're gonna rack it in. People are paying attention to you. he probably doesn't. This whole Black Lives Matter thing's probably working against him because the attention's not on him right now. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. The attention's on you. You're fresh out. Rack it in. You're gonna get so many millions of dollars right now. We're good. Just get it. You know what I'm saying?
I understand both of them. I understand 6ix9ine, and I truly understand both of them. I don't condone none of it.
Yeah.
It's like a virgin who's never had no pussy before, and he fuck a bitch with AIDS. Like,
just so I'm gonna get some pussy for my first time.
I understand. I understand why you did it. But the bitch had AIDS, bro.
Yeah.
Feel me? Like, I understand why. I understand you've never had pussy ever in your life. You don't know how it feel. And you just, I understand that. But the bitch got AIDS. Like, Akon, you're very talented.
And he's going to be you don't understand. I've never had pussy before.
You're very talented. Like, you're very talented.
Oh, man.
You got very hits. I understand why you did it, but what I don't understand is why you chose him to be your new coming out partner.
He spoke up before that. I seen that he supports it, whatever. And I understand. That's another thing that's divided. People are like, well, like I said, that was a conversation we spoke on. He has his people going to say, well, what would you do if this and that? And they don't, obviously, they're looking
they
at life through different lens.
They
never been. They're not. They live by different honor and codes than us. They're normal citizens. Yeah, well, I expect you to fucking call the police because you're probably a neighborhood watch type of person or something. Yeah. I don't know. But yeah, man. It's a shame to see what this culture has come to.
At the end of the day, he told on them because he was getting prosecuted for calling a hit on Chief Keef. So no matter what they did to him, no matter what he said he did it for, they did this to me, they did this to me, they did this to me, woo, woo, woo. You snitched to get out of what you was facing.
Yep.
What you
didn't
yourself.
Snitch. You wasn't facing. It's not like he was facing no time and just snitched because they did all that shit to him and the feds came and was like, "Well, these niggas fucked your bitch, was plotting to kidnap you and do all this." Woo, woo, woo. He like, "Oh, they was doing all that. Fuck them niggas. I'll tell everything they did." That wasn't the case.
Nah, he was scared to do his time.
He snitched. Because he was finna go to jail for calling a hit on Chief Keef on social media. Like, that's whole shit.
Yeah, no, he wanted to be a gangster. This is what it was, and when reality life hit him, and this is this happens to cats like us on the streets too. The youngsters gotta realize that when you're kicking with the homies and you're having fun barbecuing, you drinking 40s with the homeboys, and they all got guns, and you think, hey, it's cool, my homies got straps. A homie over there caught a body the other day. He a real one. I'm fucking with killers. You realize you right there. Now you riding in the car, and he catches dumping somebody.
Yeah.
You going down too, and you probably don't realize what you involved in. You're going to end up ratting on everybody. You know what I'm saying?
The thing is, 6ix9ine was a gopher.
When you
meet a gopher, you let them be a gopher. You don't try to turn him into the fucking biggest gangster or king of New York because you know that it's not in his heart.
And it's fucked up.
And you know with talking comes actions.
And it's fucked up he had to be Mexican, man.
whenever there's talking, actions always comes afterwards. So if he's doing all the talking, it's action come afterwards. And if he's not willing to do the action, somebody going to have to do the action to back up that talking. Because if nobody backs up the talking, it's not real. And if it ain't real, it's not going to sell. True. And if it's not selling, it ain't no money being made.
I think people need to separate.
They should have let Blood go pop.
Yeah.
They should have let 6ix9ine go pop and turn into the rap version of Justin Bieber. And everybody
but that
still would have had money.
Hella fast. Sometimes you may not expect that to happen. Yeah. You know.
And I feel like he was able to capitalize off of just his image and his whole
rainbow
and all
shit,
this.
Whole
but
shit.
It's fast, so, you know, and I think his team recognized that, and they just saw money.
For sure,
you know what I mean?
Sure,
they saw money.
Yeah.
They forgot about the street code and saw money.
Northern California, like, we just a little different out here. And I know you are the same way. If I sign a rapper to my label that's a square, he going to be a square rapper.
Yeah.
If you sign a rapper to your label that's a square, he gonna be a square rapper. Mm-hmm. We would never sign a motherfucking square from Delaware nigga
and try to turn him
into a fucking gangster on wax. Yeah. We would not do that.
Definitely. And it's like I said, it's different because we from a different era and a different culture. We're Bay Area. We've elaborated. You had to be a street dude to get recognition in this shit. You couldn't be a 6ix9ine. Now and now, social media, yes, but in our era, you couldn't, because we had to go do legwork. We had to go put flyers and posters and go hit clubs and hood bar. We had to do shit. We had to be in the streets, and we attacked our markets. So I was, you had to mingle with the streets to get known. Now it's different posts and stuff like that. You had to be a real motherfucker to get love in the streets. So it's easy to take this guy. I mean, look at what you just said. Go back to what Dr. Dre did with Eminem. He motherfucker came out with blonde hair. I'm the real Slim Shady. He came with his whole little weird shit talking about killing his fucking mom and shit. Let him do him, and it was a success. If you would have tried to put tattoos on your neck and talk gangster shit,
if Eminem would have tried to come out and talk like Snoop, it wouldn't have worked.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He like, so like.
Authenticity.
What was I finna say? Fuck, I forgot.
how long we in next book? We've been in a minute.
Oh, no, what I was finna say was, I've signed, I've had gangsters on my label, and I've had squares on my label. And when I have squares on my label and they make them type of songs, I tell them, that ain't you. Redo that. Or come on, bro. Come on.
We should keep it real with them. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, come on, bro. Like, you're not walking in the club shooting up everybody with an AK.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, you don't got a Maserati. I got a Maserati. You ain't got one. Don't rap about it.
Yeah, like that.
Yeah.
Not even like, that's just material shit. But I'm talking about.
Yeah, but motherfuckers
like,
lie about that shit too all the time,
yes,
though.
Yes, they do. But I'm talking about like with street shit. Like, niggas really take that shit to the heart. Yeah. And if you not willing to protect that, you can't rap about that because the motherfucker gonna test you.
Straight up.
So you can't, you feel me? You can't put that toward the forefront. And I didn't stop. Artists from like, bro, that's not you.
Because
when they sign with labels and they around like 6ix9ine, when they sign with labels and they around that type of environment and that type of energy, it gives them the confidence to rap like that in the booth. But a real CEO gonna be like, that ain't you, bro. Just stick to your shit.
That's the difference between us and them, though. Over there, they're just like, we see money, we gonna put you. But I'm going to say just real quick in my situation, I've had that happen with me, right? And there's people that were rapping out here that were rapping with people that got names. And when I work with them, I was like, how do you tell someone? And I guess you could call it out, but I'm just like, this motherfucker lying. I've had people I'm rapping with, I'm making songs with, and this motherfucker lying. Like, they it sound good. These people know these people, but they're lying, and I know them. So I shied away. Like, I can't do music. It didn't feel right. For me, I know people want to hear it, and I see my fans. How come you don't rap a song with someone no more and do this? And the little homie knows, like, I just can't, bro. It don't feel right. I'm not going to be on a song with this dude when he's lying. And then I end up being like the black sheep of it because
the
they're all still together.
That's vouching for his fuckery.
But they're all still together, fucking with each other, and I'm the bad guy because I just can't be around that bullshit. You know what I'm saying?
But you're not the bad guy when you're being
I'm
the most
from
solid.
From the outside looking in for fan base, not street shit. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
They truth ain't hit the light yet.
Yeah.
The truth already hit the light for you.
Yeah.
They gonna get there another year. They gonna see it.
They gonna see it.
Just, they just say the truth ain't hit the light for them
the
yet.
The truth always comes out when the covers get, you know
the truth ain't hit the light for them yet.
Man, yeah, bro. But shit, I mean, shit, anything else you want to touch on, bro? I think we had a good conversation today, man.
I just want to say, man, invest your money, stack your money. Open you up some businesses, you know what I'm saying? Check out Big T's Barbershop. Check out Livewire Barbershop. Check out Livewire Clothing Store. You know what I'm saying? I will shout out this dope-ass motherfucker recording studio we in, but my nigga don't rent out to you suckers because he rich, nigga.
Private shit, man.
My nigga don't rent out to you suckers because he rich, nigga. But, man, check out the motherfucking Big Tone Podcast, Livewire Records, Jay Stallion and DJ Fresh, Real World 5 in stores July 3rd.
Boy, sitting with a real Bay Area legend, man. You know, motherfucker got hits under his belt, got projects under his belt, real entrepreneurship, man. Hey, it was an honor having you today,
yes,
brother.
Yes, it was.
You
know. Oh, man, the pleasure's all mine, Tone. You already know.
Thank you for dropping them gems that you dropped, too.
I try, man. Shoot. It's called Pay It Forward, man.
That's right. Yep.
I teach somebody, they teach somebody else, they teach somebody else. Yep. That's how we all stay educated.
And we united out here in the Bay Area, man. We don't play that bullshit, man. We rock with each other, man. You know, we one big army, man.
Black
you know,
and
you
brown.
Fuck with him, you fuck with us, you fuck with us, you fuck with him. It's all love. All right, everybody, appreciate you tuning in today, man. Once again, thank you to the man, Jay Styling, for pulling up today. Icy Amy, appreciate you today for pulling up. You know, glad to have you part of the show. And thank you for everybody tuning in. Make sure you hit that like, subscribe, man. Check out all the content we're dropping, man. Go back and check out Styling's work, man. Go peep all his videos on YouTube. Check out his barbershop. We got to support one another. And once again, salute to y'all. Have a good one. Peace. Big wipe in my pocket. Pop it with my bro. Savadell, this a label and a motherfucking coach. Yeah. Big Tone came up long from the hard way. From the grams to the zippies to them whole things.